One of the most exciting scientific findings of the past half century has been the discovery of widespread trophic cascades. A trophic cascade is an ecological process which starts at the top of the food chain and tumbles all the way down to the bottom. And the classic example is what happened in the Yellowstone National Park in the United States when wolves were reintroduced in 1995. Now, we all know that wolves kill various species of animals, but perhaps we're slightly less aware that they give life to many others. Before the wolves turned up, they'd been absent for 70 years, that the numbers of deer, because there was nothing to hunt them, had built up and built up in the Yellowstone Park, and despite efforts by humans to control them, they'd managed to reduce much of the vegetation there to almost nothing. They'd just grazed it away. But as soon as the wolves arrived, even though they were few in number, they started to have the most remarkable effects. First, of course, they killed some of the deer, but that wasn't the major thing. Much more significantly, they radically changed the behavior of the deer. The deer started avoiding certain parts of the park, the places where they could be trapped most easily, particularly the valleys and the gorges. And immediately, those places started to regenerate. In some areas, the height of the trees quintupled in just 6 years. Bare valley sides quickly became forests of aspen and willow and cottonwood. And as soon as that happened, the birds started moving in. The number of songbirds and migratory birds started to increase greatly. The number of beavers started to increase because beavers like to eat the trees. And beavers, like wolves, are ecosystem engineers. They create niches for other species. And the dams they built in the rivers provided habitats for otters and muskrats and ducks and fish and reptiles and amphibians. The wolves killed coyotes. And as a result of that, the number of rabbits and mice began to rise, which meant more hawks, more weasels, more foxes, more badgers. Ravens and bald eagles came down to feed on the carrion that the wolves had left. Bears fed on it too, and their population began to rise as well, partly also because there were more berries growing on the regenerating shrubs. And the bears reinforced the impact of the wolves by killing some of the calves of the deer. Here's where it gets really interesting. The wolves changed the behavior of the rivers. They began to meander less. There was less erosion. The channels narrowed. More pools formed. More riffle sections, all of which were great for wildlife habitats. The rivers changed in response to the wolves. And the reason was that the regenerating forests stabilized the banks so that they collapse less often, so that the rivers became more fixed in their course. Similarly, by driving the deer out of some places and the vegetation recovering on the valley sides, there was less soil erosion because the vegetation stabilized that as well. So the wolves, small in number, transformed not just the ecosystem of the Yellowstone National Park, this huge area of land, but also its physical geography.
Anti-government, self-described revolutionaries have shot up a pizza restaurant as well as a Walmart in Las Vegas.
The internationally syndicated political series, The David Pac-Man Show, provides progressive talk, analysis, and interviews with the nation's youngest radio and television host, David Pac-Man. Find out more and catch up on all the latest episodes by visiting our website at freespeech.org.
know, sometimes when I'm walking down the street, I'm not necessarily looking out and seeing all these water-wasting lawns and people that aren't as connected to their neighbors and their lives as they could be. I'm walking down the street looking, going, edible oases, rainwater, fed landscape, and just looking at the possibility of these sort of landscapes up and down the streets of neighborhoods and communities all across this world. Small actions do ripple and they add up and they have a cumulative impact. And so when you're building upon your small mindful actions, you know, you have the confidence and the ability to take on something a little bit greater. So that could be nice. This, in the context of where we're at as a planet with climate change and these really big issues and people that are more disconnected and less skilled than ever, it becomes even more amazing and powerful how much of a solution this is to design these ecological gardens and to come together with shared vision and shared voice. There's never been a time where your choices have mattered more. Doing something as simple as us transforming a landscape creates a model that anybody can look at far and wide, and you're sharing food and connecting and building skills together in your own neighborhood. It's a richer way to live in normal times, but in the new normal of climate change and erratic weather and economic upheaval, it becomes essential. Whether it's me, you, Gandhi, Che, MLK, Willy Wonka, whoever, past, present, or future, the power of our daily actions is all that we have. You know, and like our community said, give me a place to stand and a lever long enough and I'll move the world. And that's what those simple actions do. They move the world every day.
I started learning about nutrition, about which, by the way, much less is known than you might think. I learned that what mattered most about one's health was not necessarily the nutrients, good or bad, that you were consuming or staying away from, or even the calorie counts, but what predicted a healthy diet more than anything else is the fact that it was being cooked by a human being and not a corporation. Corporations cook very differently than people do. They use vast amounts of salt, fat, and sugar, much more than you would ever use in your own cooking. And the reason they do that is those are three incredibly attractive and incredibly cheap ingredients. And when they're layered properly, as in a chip or pastries and forms of junk food, they're incredibly addictive. They really press our buttons. They activate our dopamine network, our cravings. And in fact, people in the industry, they don't talk about addiction in the food industry, even though they traffic in addiction. They talk about craveability. It's the same thing. And snackability is another term they use. It's a lovely word. And then the last point about corporate cooking that's important to understand is they cook different stuff than you do at home. What they're good at, in general, they don't cook that well, but things like chips, they cook incredibly well. And here's a classic food that if you make it yourself, if you've ever made French fries, you have to wash the potatoes, you have to peel the potatoes, you have to slice the potatoes, you have to fry them in a lot of oil, you have to spatter your entire stovetop, you have to clean up, and then you have this pot of oil you have to get rid of. I mean, it's really difficult, and it's a pain. They're wonderful, but it's a pain. And if you make them yourself, you'll only eat them every 6 weeks, 2 months, because it's too much work. But when you let corporations cook for you, it's so simple and so inexpensive, and they're really good, that you will have them twice a day, as many people in America do. So you see, the kinds of foods you end up with are these labor-intensive foods and desserts. These special occasion foods become everyday foods when we let industry cook for us. Eat anything you want, just cook it yourself.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
Casting around the nation, on your radio, on your TV, and online. This is the Bill Press Show.
All right, I finally got a chance to say, Happy New Year! Where you been all year? Hey, hello everybody, great to see you on this day, a Friday. Hallelujah. Yeah, lots of reasons for a hallelujah this morning. It's Friday, in January 9, and this is actually the second, right?
What?
The second Friday of the year.
Yeah, it is.
All right, so hallelujah again.
The it's first live Friday.
The first us. Live,
yes,
that's
indeed.
It. It is certainly our favorite day of the week and yours. And it is good to see you. Hope you had a great holiday season and wish you all the very, very best for this new year, 2014, which got underway.
2015. Here we are. We're 2015, baby.
Oh, I told you it's going to be a rough day.
I'm telling you.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
Uh-oh.
I thought I could make 5 minutes without making a fool of myself, but I'm not even that. it is good to be back with you, and for me, the new year starts today. I came back to town from the West Coast, had a great vacation, was feeling good, and then last Sunday, suddenly, overnight, woke up Monday morning and my face had swollen as big as a hot air balloon, as red as a matador's cape, my eyes swollen shut. And nobody knows what the hell happened, an allergic reaction to something, and it just knocked me out. Saw two doctors working on it at the same time, popped me full of medication, which of course I'm still taking, and still a little swollen as you might see, but at least I could be seen in public now, and I was contagious for a while too, so I had to just stay out of action, but... And Peter did catch a glimpse of me a couple times during. Will you please attest that I look like Elephant Man?
You were in rough shape. Yeah. You were in rough shape. The first picture you sent me.
I mean, the whole face, both sides, everything.
It was, you were, your face was so
My eyes were like slits.
They really were.
I know. I saw you Saturday night at Igor's party.
No, Saturday
and
night.
And you looked so good. And it just happened overnight. It's so amazing.
Yeah, it was. Saturday night was fine.
As soon as I saw you after your face is swollen, my first thought was, boy, I'd hate to see the other guy.
Yeah.
you looked in rough shape.
So,
welcome back. Seriously.
Thank you.
I'm glad you're back.
Yes.
Thank you. Welcome back to all of you. And here we are back together again. The whole team, Peter Ogburn, Lisa Murphy. Hello, guys.
Hey, happy Friday.
Happy New Year. And Alicia Cruz there. Ready to take your calls at 866-55-PRESS. And, of course, as always, we are here with you on your local Progressive Talk radio station. Cyprian, I didn't forget you. Just hold, hold your horses.
Patience.
Here with your local Progressive Talk radio station. And here with you on those great radio apps. The iHeart Radio and
Tune in.
The Tune In app, right. And we are also on the big screen. You can see us on Free Speech TV, of course, or on our international global video stream, TawkrTV. It's Free Speech TV. If you got a satellite dish, Dish Network, or DirecTV, and of course, on the for the video stream, it's youtube.com/Tawkr, TawkrTV. And that is thanks to the good work of our videographer, Cyprian Balding. So happy New Year to you all. It was a big day yesterday for the Pope, by the way. A very, very important visitor. I mean, he's seen President Obama and all kinds of kings and queens and important people yesterday. He got a visit, received a visit from the Queen herself, Angelina Jolie.
Whoa,
how about that?
Nice.
Conan noted the importance of it yesterday.
Today, Angelina Jolie met with Pope Francis at the Vatican. Pope Francis. After she left, Pope Francis was overheard saying, "Damn!"
That's crazy.
What's that mean in Italian?
That's pretty universal, I think.
I thought that was all right. Hey, we take off this morning with Susan Page from USA Today on board a flight Bill Press show. We'll also be talking to one of our good friends, reporter from the Agence France-Presse here in Washington, about the latest with the terrorist situation in Paris. We'll bring you up to date on that in just a minute here. And I'll talk about what we can expect out of the 114th Congress, and also kick back and talk, it's a Friday, talk a little bit about food, what we like and why we like it, how our tastes are formed. It's a good lineup here for Friday, if I must say so myself. We'll get right to the latest from Paris, but first.
This is the Full Court Peter. Press.
Just a couple of other stories making news. We go to, where else? Florida, where John Ballmer has been accused.
Trouble.
Yeah, you know where we're going.
Yeah.
John Ballmer is a man who's accused of possessing drugs, but at least you can't say he lied about it. He was in a Kmart in Hudson County, Florida, in Pasco County, Florida.
Uh-huh.
And he approached a police officer wearing a shirt that said, "Who needs drugs?" And then in parentheses underneath said, "No, seriously, I have drugs."
Oh, my gosh.
Guess what? He had drugs.
That is crazy. It's a good marketing tactic,
I
guess.
He was seen scowling in front of an animal claw game right outside the Kmart until a police officer approached him, asked him what he was up to. Turns out he was, in fact, carrying drugs. So there you go.
Standing outside of Walmart waiting for
customers,
right?
Exactly. I don't know. I know I don't have to tell you this, Bill, but it's cold outside.
Do you tell me?
It's cold outside. Maybe. And, you know, we have it bad, but it's not as bad as parts of Canada. Temperatures in Toronto are at about 16. Ottawa is at -3. Just to put this into a little bit of perspective, yesterday, Mars Curiosity reported that the weather on Mars, a relatively balmy 21 degrees where they were. Now, parts of Mars can get as low as, like, -202 degrees Celsius. So it's not like a place you want to visit besides just the lack of oxygen and all of that stuff. But it was warmer in parts of Mars than it was in Canada. Yes.
Well, Carol and I have been thinking about a warm place for a retirement home.
There you go.
Take a long time to get there.
And a big announcement from the president yesterday when he was on Air Force One, put out a very short video with short on details, but he's going to put more details behind it today. Free community college. He put out a statement. It was only about 7 seconds long on the video, and he says, I want to propose free community college for anybody who's willing to work for it. He's going to unveil the plan today in Tennessee, and I imagine he'll talk more about it in his State of the Union.
Yeah, the White House this morning has put out a fact sheet that I just got it early this morning in anticipation of the president's visit down to Tennessee. This is based on a recent report or book, I'm not sure, that caught the president's attention about what free high school has done to this country and how we benefited from everybody getting free high school. And so it's such a great idea. And take it two steps more and have first 2 years of community college free, which I think would be fabulous.
Yeah.
And you couple that with something I feel so strongly about, free universal preschool. Then, we're finally taking education seriously, I think.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So,
I love it.
Yeah. Thanks, Peter.
By the way, it shouldn't come as a surprise that John Boehner immediately came out and said he didn't like it.
Oh, yeah.
He did. He said it seemed
No,
he came out and said this is a talking point and not a plan. Those are his words.
You know, come on, Boehner. Grow up. Here we are. Let's talk about the latest situation in Paris. I know you talked about it yesterday. And by the way, thanks to Peter, to you, for filling in for a couple of days.
Sure.
And Clinton Yates as well, while I was dealing with my face. And you've talked about the situation in Paris. It is so troubling. I'd love to get your thoughts on it. But as we get this day started, here is the latest. The two suspects, remember there were three suspects originally in the just brutal, brutal assassination of those 12 journalists at Charlie Hebdo in the center of Paris. One of whom, the 18-year-old, turned himself in. There are still questions about whether he was involved at all. They originally said he had driven the getaway car. The video that I saw showed the gunman getting in the seat of the driver's seat and driving off. Mm-hmm. With the, so who knows? But he turned himself in the first day. The other two have been on the run. They have now been cornered and are surrounded in a small village outside of Paris, Dammartin-en-Goële. It's near Charles de Gaulle Airport. The police have made contact with them. They have taken a hostage. I haven't seen anything yet about the hostage. The police are communicating with them, allegedly, reportedly, I guess the police, suspects told the police that, quote, they want to die as martyrs. But at any rate, I think we can be relieved that the French police, who are terrific at this stuff and have a lot of experience at, have tracked them down, have surrounded them, and now it's only a matter of time, hopefully, that they can resolve this without any harm coming to that hostage. But the whole attack does raise such serious questions about whatever you want to call it, Islamic extremism, or call it the old war on terror, or just the existence of terror around the world. I mean, I was stunned last night when Scott Pelley on CBS News pointed out, after spending like half the newscast on Paris, the fact that this could happen in such a city as Paris, known for its freedom and freedom of expression and use of satire, it could happen in the heart of Paris is what has really shocked the entire world. But yesterday, while we were focused on that one attack that killed 12 people, yesterday, there was another attack in Nigeria of the Boko Haram, where some, I think, 100 people were killed in a series of attacks. There was another suicide bombing in Iraq, where dozens were killed. There was a suicide bombing or somebody driving a car into a crowd and blowing it up in Yemen. And it went on and on. All of these attacks by the same evil forces, Islamic extremists around the world. And it just makes you, I don't know the answer. I don't know that anybody knows the answer about how do you end this?
I just wanted to, there's a little bit of breaking news breaking just came news. In from CNN. They said the two suspects in the Charlie Hebdo attack spoke to the police by phone just moments ago. They said that they will die as martyrs, a French lawmaker told a TV station. So this is not good. I mean, and this is not, if they had their way, this is not going to end well.
Well, they've got their guns. They can use them on themselves, as far as I'm concerned. Yeah. But they're not dying as martyrs. They are not dying as martyrs. They are dying as cold-blooded killers, evil, evil killers. That's what they're dying as. I mean, for them to assume they could, they might as well say, we want to die as saints.
Yeah.
Or we want to die as Pope. They're not dying as martyrs. Thanks, Peter. So, I mean, the question I have is, in terms of values, in terms of looking at placing any value on human life, you know, those of us who reject that kind of, their kind of thinking, we're right and they're wrong. There's no doubt about that. Let's never question that. But why is it that so many young people today are attracted to that kind of lifestyle, that idea that you don't put any value on human life, or you don't put any value certainly on women, and that you can just go in and kill, just brutally murder innocent people, and think that that helps you, advances your cause, or improves the human condition on this planet? It is so far from everything that we believe. that it's just impossible to, you know, again, how do you deal with it? Obviously, we've learned militarily is not, military might is not the answer. One of these guys, the older brother, allegedly was a pretty decent guy. He performed rap and all that kind of stuff. Became a militant radical, he says, because he was outraged by the U.S. invasion of Iraq. That was George Bush's answer. Let's go in and kill them all. That didn't work so well, did it?
No. Just,
look, now we have ISIS. Then we had Al-Qaeda. Now we have ISIS. So it's the military is not the answer, but what is the answer? What is it about democracy? What is it about freedom that they would prefer basic slavery to? You know, they make young people today making that choice with their feet to go there and fight with these guys or get trained by these guys. Why?
It's an unanswerable question. I mean, from where I sit, but I mean, you look at a lot of these type of actions. It all comes down to religious fanaticism.
It is.
I mean, as these attacks were happening, as they were gunning people down, they said, "We're avenging the name of the Prophet Muhammad." There have been a lot of other attacks that are religiously motivated that aren't from Islam. So let's not have that conversation, but. This religious fanaticism is so out of control that's the driving force behind all these.
But
things.
See, even that I reject in this sense. Just like I said, these guys are not dying as martyrs. They may say they're dying, but they're not dying as martyrs. They're not doing this out of any religious motivation either. They say they are.
Right.
But there
is no
religion. There is no religion. There is no God. I don't care who your God is. There is no God that would tolerate or accept their kind of behavior.
Yep.
None. And for anybody to say that, no matter who they are, totally wrong. And by the way, we know that these Islamic extremists are not the only ones to kill and have killed in the name of religion. Anyway, we're just getting started. And then the other question about this is, of course, if you're a publisher, what do you do? And it's a big question now for big publications like the Washington Post, the New York Times, USA Today. We'll talk to Susan Page later in this hour. You cover the story. Do you help as part of covering the story? Do you publish the cartoons that allegedly angered these gunmen in Paris? 866-55-PRESS. Our conversation starts today on that terrorist attack at the Charlie Hebdo headquarters. 866-55-77-377.
This is the Bill Press Show.
Tune into Free Speech TV for Democracy Now!, a national, independent, award-winning news program bringing you people and perspectives rarely seen on corporate media.
Grunt work. Love it, hate it, useful, not useful.
Necessary.
Our social entrepreneurs are people who have been on the front lines of social change. I've learned so much from talking with them. This is Cafe Impact, and I'm Jonathan Lewis.
I will say that I think is a challenge for anyone, especially the new workforce as they come in, is the ability to accept grunt work with grace.
The most boring, awful details are the most important elements of doing this work. From the way you save names in your Rolodex to the way you bank and you deposit checks. The truth is, this work isn't glamorous, it's rewarding. You don't go into this for the glamour, you go into it for the impact. And so it takes that determination to do the scut work to actually get anywhere.
It can be really challenging in a first job for someone who's coming out of finishing school to have the enthusiasm that they do to make the type of social impact that they've dreamed of. And now they're here in this first job and all of a sudden they're shouldered with all this grunt work and they don't understand and they don't get it and they're resentful.
Talk more about the power of it. Answering phones.
Sure, I did that myself, you know, took out the trash, you know, clean cleaned offices when I had to, and it's all good. There's power in being a good team player and in being somebody who sometimes has to support other people's leadership before you get to have your own moment in the sun.
Is it hard to wait?
It is absolutely hard to wait, especially if you're an alpha female like I am.
I think grunt work can help a new employee build trust internally and teach them the nuances of how an organization is run so that they can have a real good sense of what HR is doing, what finance is doing, what all of the other departments are, and that actually makes them a better employee in the long run.
So in my role on a daily basis, I literally can be looking at a new venture in software. Mm-hmm. We could be looking at a microfinance deal. I could be making coffee, taking out the trash, and riding a tractor on any given day.
Have you found people who thought it was demeaning that they were given this job, work in the front office and make the coffee when they graduated with all A's from this great university?
People like that just don't last very long in our world. If your approach to life is that, you know, you're so smart and you're such a fabulous entrepreneur that you can't understand why people aren't giving you opportunities, it's really hard to advance.
Tune into Gay USA with hosts Ann Northrup and Andy Hum for in-depth coverage of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender news. Watch Gay USA every week, only on Free Speech TV.
At Earth Justice, we defend the environment in the courtroom. Join our fight. When you take a seat, you take a stand. Earth Justice, because the Earth needs a good lawyer.
This is the Bill Press Show.
At 27 minutes again after the hour here with the latest from Paris, the two suspects remaining have been are surrounded. They've been chased down to a small village outside of Paris. Police are there. They're in telephone communication with them. So what does this say to publishers around the world? The Post, Washington Post, is quoted as saying that the Post will avoid publication of any material that is deliberately or needlessly offensive to members of religious groups. The New York Times basically says the same thing. The USA Today says it's discussing whether or not to publish the offensive cartoons. Do we really want to live in a time when nobody, not even one magazine on the planet could publish a cartoon that some Muslims find offensive?
This,
I don't want to live in that age.
It's the Bill Press Show.
This is my computer.
This is your computer. Let's go on the internet.
Let's go. Flick it.
Yes.
Okay.
I cursor in between the R and the E. Pricing data, I want you to just push the period.
She's going to love me all over again.
That's it. Jamaica, here you go.
Here we go.
Good right. Job.
Thank you. And I did it by myself. Feel smarter.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket again. It's like, hello, that's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide and go seek.
Hey!
do.
Same time next week?
Well, of course.
Put away a few bucks, feel like a million bucks. For free tips to help you save, go to
Feed the Pig.
All right. I know this isn't any fun to talk about, but we should. Okay. So who's going to do what?
I'll pack the dead batteries.
Great.
I'll only put what I don't need into a duffel bag.
Perfect. That's totally unhelpful.
No problem.
Meanwhile, I will try to comfort everyone by speaking in a calm voice.
And I'll try to get the generator going without any gas.
Oh, let's not forget the cell phones, which probably won't work.
Right.
And who is going to handle supplies?
I can forget to do a list for us.
Thanks, pal.
Well, I think we couldn't be any less prepared. I'm proud of you guys.
Talk to your kids about who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information.
Hey, thanks for stopping by. You know, I followed your character since the first episode. I'm a big fan, big fan.
Thank you.
And listen, your storyline, it makes for incredible TV drama. Thing is, your drug use is very adult content. Too adult for the kids. So I'm gonna have to block you. Well, have a good one.
You're a nice lady.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
You wouldn't...
All right, 34 minutes now after the hour on this Friday, January 9, as police close in. Peter, what's the latest from outside of Paris?
Breaking news just kind of coming in as this is unfolding.
Dommartin-en-Goële.
That's it. That's the city that they have sealed off the entire town. They have warned all residents to remain at home. Children are to be kept safe inside of schools. I mentioned they sealed off the entire town. They appear to have cornered the attackers in that town near that airport, as you mentioned. Again, the one politician saying that the attackers spoke to police earlier today. today and told them that they plan on dying as martyrs, is their words. So it's unfolding live, and we're keeping an eye on it as it happens.
I am personally happy to give them a chance to die.
Absolutely.
Not as martyrs, however. They will not die as martyrs. They do not. You don't get to name yourself as a martyr.
That's right. Right.
Yeah. I want to die as a saint, too, but I never will. I'd like to die as an angel, right? Okay. That's it. I'm announcing right now. I'm going to die as an angel.
There you go.
All right? So there. It just shows how phony this whole operation is. I mean, but it's serious. We laugh about it. It's serious. It's a serious problem worldwide. It's, you know, and these one of these brothers went to Syria, trained with Al-Qaeda on the Arabian Peninsula, and then came back. Whether they were linked to them and got orders from them to conduct this attack, unlikely. They just came back and said, okay, these are the tactics that we use. Now, who's going to be our target? Mm-hmm. And they chose this target because they were offended by the cartoons that this Charlie Hebdo would publish. Brandy's calling from Lansing, Michigan. Hey, Brandy, thanks for joining us.
Well, welcome back, Bill.
Thank you, and Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year as well. What you need to understand is that freedom requires courage. It requires responsibility for your actions.
Yep.
I don't buy this martyr poppycock, okay? They're criminals.
Yes.
They need to be taken alive. That would be the biggest insult to their Allah.
It would be. And by the way, I totally agree. I mean, that would be the best outcome. Taken alive, put on trial, and just show the world, you know, and show others who might think of doing the same thing, you know, what the consequences are. And also, I think more people, the more exposure to people like this, I would hope, the less attractive their message would be. So let's hope that's the outcome, Brandy. So good to hear from you. Out in Chicago on the great WCPT. Hello, Tony. Boy, it's cold in Chicago, too.
Hi,
Tony.
Bill, welcome back.
Thank you.
I was just going to say, I think you guys are all missing the point.
Go ahead.
In the sense of it's the hypocrisy of it all. See, yeah. White people, you've never been oppressed, you know, and the bottom line is, you know, whether these guys are twisted or however you want to look at it, white people have taught a terrorist what to do, because obviously 12 white people getting killed in France has stopped the world, where when you just said the same terrorists, the same ISIS people, the same sex have killed hundreds of people of color, you know, in terms of other Arabs or, you know, and black people here in the United States die the same way, but it's no consequence.
I love you, but I mean, if these were 12 black people killed in Paris, we'd be just as outraged about it. Their race has nothing to do with it. And the point I made is, you know, yeah, Christians did that in the past, and it was wrong what we did to the Native Americans, what we did to black Americans in the South. I mean, wrong. But Christians, we've grown out of that. These Islamic extremists still think that's the way to go.
But
right?
That's just them. That's not Islam as a whole.
You're right about that. You're absolutely right. And if I didn't make that point, I should have. And you're absolutely right. And I, by the way, I really applaud that the head of the Grand Mosque in Paris, who came out and said, no, we don't like the cartoons that they run, but they got every right to publish them.
Mm.
And who are we to say they can't publish it? He's a great leader for Islam, I think, and so.
But I'm not attacking Islam.
I'm attacking this extremism, whether it's Christian extremism or Islam extremism.
Right, but it's the lives of the people. That the point is, they're doing this because there's much more traction. I hate to put it that way.
Why?
If you kill somebody white, than if you kill anybody else.
If that factors into their,
you mean you get more
reasoning,
attention if you kill somebody white?
Absolutely.
Well, then why are these guys what are they doing with these attacks in Iraq or these attacks in Yemen or
the Boko Haram in
Nigeria? They're not killing white people. And by the way, the police officer who was killed in Paris, as you know, was a Muslim.
Yeah.
Exactly. I'm not saying that they're correct. Saying what the world has taught you is that if you want to make a point, that's who you kill, because the same, it's just not the same when you kill someone of color. I mean, over and over and over and over again. If white boys here in the United States were being killed by the police at the same rate, something would get done.
I think we gave a lot of attention to Eric Gardner, and we'll give a lot more to that case. I think we gave a lot of attention to Michael Brown, and rightfully so, and that will continue. And I'll tell you one thing. The video yesterday that came out, we've already talked about Tamir Rice, that 12-year-old kid in Cleveland who was mercilessly gunned down by some guy who never should have had a police officer uniform on. That video yesterday is just absolutely outrageous. Just, I mean, that guy does not belong on the streets of America, that police officer. Never should have been a cop, as I said, in the first place. We paid a lot of attention to that case. So I just have to disagree. And I'll tell you one thing. These two killers, they didn't care when they walked into the offices of that of the Charlie Hebdo, whether the people sitting around that conference table were black or white. They didn't care. They just didn't like their publication. They were going to kill anybody responsible for it. Hey, Tony, good to hear from you. Paul in Woodinville, Washington, on the West Coast. Hi, Paul.
Hi, Bill. Look, here's what I'd like to hear. It's part of analysis, and certainly if you're going to publish any of these cartoon frames or images, as part of covering the story is whether or not this stuff is even funny. I mean, look, this is not just as free speech. It's not just an article or an essay. And to make my point more clear, when you look at classical satire such as Voltaire's Candide or Jonathan Swift's Modest Proposal, they were kind of funny, even though they were about things that were sort of gross, right?
Right.
So, is this stuff even funny? That's the point I'd like to hear.
I hear you, Paul, but my question to you is, who are you to decide?
Right, right.
Who else does anybody think it's funny? I mean,
no, some people do. Yeah, let me tell you something. Pat Oliphant's a good friend of mine. I think he's the best editorial cartoonist in the country. I don't find every one of Pat's cartoons funny, but some people do. That's why he's published in like 500 newspapers. You see what I mean, Paul? Put it out there, and some people will find it funny, and some won't.
And you could also extend that to whether or not one person finds it in poor taste and another person finds it in poor taste. And what's offensive to one person is not offensive to someone else. So who's the decider? Who decides this is funny, this is appropriate, or this is not funny, or too inappropriate, you know?
I have an idea. How about Paul from Woodinville, Washington? you're going to be the judge, Paul.
Oh, okay, well, I'm not talking about the poor taste stuff.
I meant the funny stuff.
You can't legislate.
He's
that.
The funny guy. He's the funny judge. Paul,
okay.
You are the funny judge. I appreciate you volunteering for the job from now on. We'll just have every editorial cartoon pre-publication sent to Paul out in Woodinville, Washington. We'll be right back with Susan Page from USA Today.
This is the Bill Press Show.
At Earth Justice, we defend the environment in the courtroom. Join our fight. When you take a seat, you take a stand. Earth Justice, because the Earth needs a good lawyer.
Tune in to Gay USA with hosts Ann Northrup and Andy Hum for in-depth coverage of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender news. Watch Gay USA every week, only on Free Speech TV.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC. or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys.
And then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
Two anti-government self-described revolutionaries have shot up a pizza restaurant as well as a Walmart in Las Vegas.
The internationally syndicated political series, The David Pac-Man Show, provides progressive talk, analysis, and interviews with the nation's youngest radio and television host, David Pac-Man. Find out more and catch up on all the latest episodes by visiting our website at freespeech.org.
Tune into Free Speech TV for Democracy Now!, a national, independent, award-winning news program bringing you people and perspectives rarely seen on corporate media.
Tips and information. A public service.
TV and online. This is the Bill Press Show.
All right, 13 minutes now before the top of the hour on this Friday, January 9. Lots of reasons I'm glad to be back in the saddle. Number one reason, to say hello to our good friend Susan Page, Washington Bureau Chief of USA Today. Hello and Happy New Year, Susan.
Happy New Year, Bill, but your number one reason, really? You must say that to all your guests.
No, you don't understand. This is my first day back. And that you are the first guest.
Oh, my. What an honor. Okay, then.
So there you go. All right, Susan, I have to ask you whether USA Today has made a decision about publishing the offensive cartoons that Charlie Hebdo paid the price for.
Well, yesterday we did not publish those cartoons. There was a long discussion about whether to do so.
I'm sure.
Because on the one hand, you don't want to be cowed into not publishing something because of attacks. On the other hand, we have a general policy where we don't publish things that are going to be offensive. You know, we don't racially offensive, mm-hmm. offensive to religious groups. In general, we try not to mm-hmm. to republish material that's offensive. So there was a debate, and yesterday we did not run the particular, we ran some cartoons, but not the ones that were seen as most offensive of the Prophet Muhammad.
Which I think is the same decision made by the Washington Post and the New York Times.
Yes, but not it's not one of those easy calls.
Yeah,
you know, it's one of those hard ones.
You know, my knee-jerk reaction is, you know, we should show the photos. But there was a very good explanation by Brian Stelter of CNN who said, look, yeah, you might say that, but we have people in various corners of the world who we can't vouch for their safety as well as we can vouch for it right here in America. And so when we speak and we put those pictures out, we're speaking for them and we can't put them in harm's way.
That's also a factor. But it's also true that there are, you know, the terrible beheadings of the American journalists by ISIS. We didn't show pictures that showed the actual beheading because it's too brutal and shocking. Not that you can't see them. You can go on the internet. You can see them if you want to. And that's true also of the cartoons. But that there are some limits to what you actually post on your website and put in your newspaper.
So what does it say for the work of editorial cartoonists?
It says it's powerful, doesn't it?
It sure does, yeah.
You know, that we've heard a lot about the pen is mightier than the sword. Maybe this is a case that just illustrates how threatened terrorist can be by the act of a satirical cartoon.
Yeah, and just by an image like that. I thought, to me, seeing the crowds in Paris in front of Notre Dame yesterday, and they were like holding up pencils. Right?
Yes. So powerful.
That was their weapon. God, it's just...
You saw big gatherings elsewhere. One in China, foreign journalists in China got together and had... had a gathering to demonstrate their support, and it just underscores kind of the power of a free press and the importance of allowing commentary, even commentary that some people are going to find offensive.
I understand the decision made by the Post, and I said earlier, I grew up in a small segregated town in Delaware, northern Delaware, Susan. And, there were no jokes that were not jokes about blacks or Poles or Italians or Jews or, you know, whatever. And, we should not be publishing or repeating that kind of stuff today, right? At the same time, I kind of want a world where there's one magazine that can do it and everybody can sort of live with that, you know?
Well, you can say that.
Because I don't have to buy it or read it.
Yeah, exactly. You can say. I mean, it's the essence of the First Amendment, right? It doesn't protect speech that we all agree is great. It protects speech that we find offensive or that goes too far. I mean, that is the essential protection of the First Amendment.
Susan, President Obama is going down to Tennessee today with a pretty bold announcement. It's already been put out by the White House. His proposal is first 2 years of community college free for every American.
Well, you know, given the incredible cost of college now and the burden that a lot of Americans are carrying with college loans, you can say this is a great idea. But does it seem a problem to you, Bill, that the White House is refusing to say how much it would cost and how they'd pay for it?
Of course, which makes you question how real it is, right?
That's right. Is this a serious proposal or is this just, you know?
But if you couple that with the idea of universal preschool, right?
Yes.
That I think you're really, in terms of the concept, the idea, and what good it would do for this country, I think it's phenomenal.
Well, right? you can certainly see the importance of doing things that help people who are in the middle class and the working class aspire to success, and universal preschool and 2 years of free community college would certainly go to that. But if you want to be taken seriously in a political debate, it seems to me you have to outline a path that might get you there.
Yeah, and I hope you can count on us to push. David Jackson and I will be pushing Josh Earnest on that point. One other thing quickly. Look at the 114th Congress. I've been doing some interviews about it this week. When I look at it, I think it could go one of either ways. I think it could be more partisan gridlock, or I think Boehner and McConnell could actually decide we got to get something done. Obama certainly wants to get some things done, and they might actually get Congress working again. Which way do you think it could?
You know, Bill, I agree. Of course, we are both just sunny optimists.
There you go.
In all circumstances.
Yeah.
But I think it can't get worse, so I think it might get better.
Oh, good for you. Yeah, all right.
I mean, that's a weird optimism, but I'll take it.
My column today, which we'll be posting for all of our listeners, is Don't Despair About 2015 Yet. Right?
Yes.
I think there's a chance.
I think there is, too.
I think there's a chance. And you know what? It's Charlie Brown and the football all over again, maybe, Susan. But you and I'm glad, the eternal optimist. I'm glad I'm not the only one. All right. Well, welcome back and Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you, Bill. Lots of good things
in 2015. Thanks. Susan Page, USAtoday.com.
This is the Bill Press Show.
What gets you into college? Good SAT scores? High GPA? Lots of extracurriculars?
Sure, but what you really need is money.
If you don't have the cash, you'll need a loan.
And we mean huge student loans, because the cost of college has risen 1,000% in the last 30 years.
This means big money for the banks that collect fees and interest.
Now, millions of young people are starting their adult lives with an average of $29,000 of loans on their backs.
Altogether, we're talking $1.2 trillion in student debt.
And more people are finding it impossible to pay them back. Welcome to the student debt crisis.
The increasing demand for higher education and cuts to state funding gave colleges a huge incentive to keep inflating prices.
I graduated about a year ago. currently in $35,000 of debt.
I am in debt about like $25,000.
I owe $23,000.
I owe over $50,000 in student loans.
38.8 million Americans owe money on a student loan.
And the biggest names in banking are making huge profits off the booming student loan industry.
Sallie Mae, the largest provider of private student loans, made $949 million last year.
They only give you about 6 months to look for a job. You have to start paying like that, back the loan. Like it's very pressuring, especially nowadays. It's very hard to find a job.
Over half of the students graduating in 2012 could not find a decent paying job.
They either had low wage jobs or unpaid internships or were unemployed altogether.
So you can't make the payments. You start incurring late fees, which makes the loan even harder to pay off.
And it stays with you for years, even decades.
Right now, a third of the people who started repaying their loans are delinquent or in default.
That's 13.7 million people, more than the populations of Chicago, New York, and San Francisco combined. Worse, it's not just the borrowers who are in trouble. Many loans require co-signers.
So if the student is unable to pay, that co-signer, a father, a mother, or a grandparent, is now on the hook.
Even a grandparent's Social Security benefits can be garnished to pay the loan.
We should have an answer to this. If you get really behind in your car payment or your credit cards, you can file for bankruptcy.
But Congress has made it nearly impossible to discharge student loans through bankruptcy.
Big institutions make big profits while students try to make ends meet under crushing debt.
Is this how we want our education system to work?
The whole point of going to college is to get the career you want. But lately that's been discouraged because no one can afford school. You get a job just to pay off your student loans.
We need higher education, not higher debt.
Sign up to end the student debt crisis at higheredndebt.org.
Is the Bill Press Show.
Jerome Cartillier from Agence France-Presse at the top of the next hour in the latest from Paris. Peter?
So, you know, we got the news yesterday that Barbara Boxer, senator from California, is going to be retiring.
I know. My good friend, known her for a long, long time.
So, of course, the question now becomes, who's going to run for her seat? There might be one clue, one small clue, who might be eyeing it. On Twitter yesterday, a parody account popped up. At Scott Brown, CA.
Oh.
It's a joke. It's a joke for now, anyway. But there is a Scott Brown, CA for California.
Yeah, but what's interesting about that is Scott Brown is not the first Republican to file for that seat. Actually, Alan Keyes was the first.
Of course.
Yeah, right.
Of course.
So there'll be a Republican primary.
Oh, man.
Both of them, stay out of California. We don't want you.
This is the Bill Press Show.
All right. I know this isn't any fun to talk about, but we should. Okay. So who's going to do what?
I'll pack the dead batteries.
Great.
I'll only put what I don't need into a duffel bag.
Perfect. That's totally unhelpful.
No problem.
Meanwhile, I will try to comfort everyone by speaking in a calm voice.
And I'll try to get the generator going without any gas.
Oh, let's not forget the cell phones, which probably won't work.
Right.
And who is going to handle supplies?
I can forget to do a list for us.
Thanks, pal.
Well, I think we couldn't be any less prepared. I'm proud of you guys.
Talk to your kids about who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
Just this month, my bill was like $138.
Even at one phone call a week cost me $40 to $50 every month.
I am living on a fixed income of SSI, so this is really a great hardship.
Families are being punished. When they incarcerate your children, they incarcerate the whole family.
In 2011, the Media Action Grassroots Network, Working Narratives, and Prison Legal News founded the Campaign for Prison Phone Justice, an effort to call on the FCC to address the cost of interstate phone calls. The campaign mobilized prisoners to send hundreds of letters. Advocates and families filled out postcards, met with elected officials, and signed petitions. Partnerships were formed across the political spectrum and with groups in the criminal justice, civil rights, and public interest community. The film distribution company Participant Media and director Ava DuVernay joined the fight through a social action campaign tied to the release of the feature film, Middle of Nowhere. In an effort to push the FCC to act, the campaign hosted a historic rally outside of the Federal Communications Commission where, for the first time, families of prisoners, elected officials, civil rights, and faith leaders came together to call for an end to predatory phone rates.
We're all held captive when predatory phone companies gouge our families.
My son has been incarcerated now for over 10 years, and my husband estimates that in the time we spent over $25,000 on prison phone calls.
My hero's not yours, you probably arrested them. Your school's probably neglected them. They spawn thoughts, you probably infected them. Feed us with your fetus, you can lay us next to them. FBI call it major crimes. Babies making babies cry.
Same time next week?
Well, of course.
Put away a few bucks, feel like a million bucks. For free tips to help you save, go to
Feed the Pig.
At Earth Justice, we defend the environment in the courtroom.
Join our fight. When you take a seat, you take a stand. Earth Justice, because the Earth needs a good lawyer.
Two anti-government, self-described revolutionaries have shot up a pizza restaurant as well as a Walmart in Las Vegas.
The internationally syndicated political series, The David Pac-Man Show, provides progressive talk, analysis, and interviews with the nation's youngest radio and television host, David Pac-Man. Find out more and catch up on all the latest episodes by visiting our website at freespeech.org.
Broadcasting around the nation, on your radio, on your TV, and online, this is The Bill Press Show.
Okay, you've heard it from everybody else. Now you'll hear it, finally, from me. Happy New Year. Yeah, it means I'm finally back. What do you say? Good to see you out there in Radio Land on your local progressive talk radio station. Good to see you on TV Land on Free Speech TV and TawkrTV. Hello, everybody, and happy Friday, January 9. The Bill Press Show coming to you live from Washington, D.C. in our studio on Capitol Hill right here in Washington. My thanks to Peter Ogburn and to Clinton Yates for filling in for the last few days. I came back feeling great after a great trip to the West Coast and somehow picked up an allergic reaction to something, they still don't know what, which resulted in the fact that my face just swelled as big as a hot air balloon, eyes closed, face red. And not fit to be seen in public and feeling like crap. But at any rate, after the good work of two doctors and a lot of rest over the last 4 days, I'm not quite back to normal, but at least I can be seen in public now.
You look so much better today than you did earlier this week.
Your bar is pretty low here, but I appreciate that.
You may have been as red as John Boehner.
Well, no, it wasn't that bad. You weren't orange.
I was going to say, I wasn't orange. But it was really weird. And I would tell you not to eat or whatever I ate or something. But I have no idea. Yeah. And docs can't figure it out. Anyhow, it's good to be back. We've got lots and lots to talk about. Our team here, Peter Ogburn and Alicia Murphy, of course, as always, guys.
Hey, good morning.
Alicia Cruz there for your phone calls. Phone calls at 866-55-PRESS. Keep those phones humming, Cyprian Bolding, as always, our videographer on the job. I really, really wanted to be here yesterday, and sorry I couldn't be, to celebrate, help you all celebrate Elvis's 80th birthday.
That's
can
right.
you imagine?
That's
Elvis,
right.
80 years old. But we'll never forget the great songs of Elvis. We'll also never forget, he had a temper, and he showed
a little bit of a drug problem.
He showed it one night in Las Vegas when rumors went around that he had been.
Don't you say he was strung out.
No, don't you dare say that. A hotel employee did, and Elvis talked about it in his show that night.
I got sick here that one night, had 102 temperature, they wouldn't let me perform. From three different sources, I heard I was strung out on heroin.
Ooh.
I swear to God, hotel employees, Jack, bellboys, freaks that carry your luggage up to the room, people working around, you know, talking, and I was sick. I had a doctor, had the flu, and I got over one day. It was I.
Right,
all across this town, strung out.
Strung out.
I told him earlier, and don't you get offended, ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking to somebody else. If I find or hear the individual that has said that about me, I'm going to break your damn neck, you son of a bitch.
Yay, hey, Elvis!
Wait, he's not only going to break your damn neck, you SOB, he'll do more than that.
That is dangerous. That is damaging to myself, to my little daughter, to my father, to my friends, my doctor.
Doctor.
To everybody in my relationship with you. My relationship with up here on the stage, it is dangerous. I will pull your damn tongue out by the roots.
Yikes.
I don't mess with Elvis,
Come
man.
Come on, Ebbish.
Pull your damn tongue out by the roots.
Easy there, Ebbish.
Roots. Yeah, all right. Happy birthday, Elvis, at any rate.
That's right, Jack.
Relax, Jack. 10 minutes after 7 now. We are going to be talking with Kevin Barron from Defense One at the half hour about the threat of terrorism around the world. Take a look at the 114th Congress and a look at how our taste developed, to what foods we like and what we don't. All of that in the next hour. But we start this hour with the day's biggest story, the week's biggest story. A tragic story of the shock the entire world out of Paris, where 12 people, 10 journalists, 2 security guards, the security guard and 1 policeman killed at the offices of assassinated, brutally murdered in downtown Paris at the offices of Charlie Hebdo, the weekly satirical magazine. Jerome Cartillier is a reporter here in France, a good friend at the White House for Agence France-Presse, joins us on our news line this morning. Jerome, bonjour et bonne année.
Merci. Good morning, Bill.
Good morning. What is the latest that you know about the search for these suspects around Paris?
The hunt seems to be heading for a showdown. The two suspects are cornered now in the northeast of Paris, a few kilometers away from Charles de Gaulle Airport. Mm-hmm. They're surrounded now. They're holding someone hostage. That's what we know. So there's a standoff with the police, and we'll see how it develops in the coming minutes and hours.
The French police, I've been pretty impressed with their actions the last couple of days. I mean, they're a seriously well trained force, ready for situations like this, aren't they?
Yes, they are. No. I mean, we've had past situations, not similar, but obviously tense and the terrorist situations in the past. So yes, they are ready. You also have to understand there's a massive mobilization police-wise in France. The country is in a state of shock since the attack happened, and therefore the entire police force is really has been mobilized to try to find these two suspects and arrest them.
I have heard from my friends in Paris who are really in a state of shock. One of them said, democracy is in danger worldwide. Another one said, just the world is crazy. What do you hear from your family and your friends in France? And what is your own reaction to this happening in the City of Light?
Well, it was obviously a major shock in Paris and, elsewhere in the country. That being said, there have been different reactions. As you probably saw yesterday, the front page of the daily paper, Le Monde, was the French 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
It did spark a debate. Not everybody would agree with that. In other words, it is a major shock. Now they are as horrific as the attack is. Some have argued that there is a massive difference in scale, and nobody would deny that. Not only in scale in terms of number of people who died,
sure,
but also about the modus operandi. So there is a debate about how to put things into perspective to an extent, but that will probably come a bit later. Again, for the time being, it's more about mourning. There'll be a major Republican march in Paris on Sunday. Some people are talking about more than 1 million people that could show up.
Mm.
So that's really where we are for the moment. It's about a sense of unity.
The video that I saw of people in front of Notre Dame, when the bells were ringing yesterday, and they were just standing there holding pencils, as a symbol of the pen mightier than the sword, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah, very moving.
As you probably saw, it's also the New Yorker's front page today. They came out early, and it's a pencil at the top of the Eiffel Tower, or the Eiffel Tower ending up as a pencil.
Oh, I haven't seen that yet.
Very strong front page.
Very, very powerful. Now, so what I fear, and I know a lot of people fear, I guess, is, or a question maybe, what impact this could have? I mean, let's face it, the immigration has always been a serious problem going back to the days of Algeria, right, with France and the treatment of immigrants. And France, I believe, has the largest Muslim population of immigrants of any other country in Europe. And then you've got this National Front, the extreme right wing of Paris, which is sort of France, anti-immigrant. How is this going? Is this going to inflame that situation? And who do you think ultimately would they be able to exploit it to their political benefit?
No, I do not think it's going to inflame it. That being said, you can see the debate is going to come up in the days to come. Prime Minister Manuel Valls said a couple of hours ago that made it very clear that this was France was at war against terrorism. It was certainly not a war against religion. But there have been, since yesterday, there's a debate, the political debate started around precisely that Republican march that is going to take place on Sunday. Political parties are basically divided over whether or not to invite the Front National, which is the far-right party from Marine Le Pen. Some have argued that since there is unity, all political parties should be invited regardless. Others believe that the Front National is a different breed, a different type of party, and shouldn't join. One should note, for example, this morning, François Hollande, for the very first time, invited Marine Le Pen at the Élysée Palace
really?
To discuss with her. Yeah, and which was rather unprecedented.
Yeah.
I think for the coming days, I think the unity will prevail in terms of how people react. I think that political debate will grow bigger and bigger as the events fade away, if you will.
May I ask you, why have you referred to it as a Republican rally? For obviously calling it a Republican rally in the United States has a different meaning.
Yeah.
What does it mean to French people?
To French people, it's really about the Republic, and it's about standing under one. You could call it there's probably a different way to put it here, but definitely over there, it's all about being under one, one united Republic.
I got it. So a unity rally, basically, right?
Yeah, exactly.
With all political parties taking part, and anyone of any faith or color or whatever invited to take part.
And on the day, the day it happened, there were already, I think, more than 100,000 people gathered in major cities, in Paris, but in Lyon, where I come from, in Marseille, other places. Again, I think we're gearing up for something massive on Sunday in Paris.
Charlie Hebdo, I knew the magazine not well. Le Canard Enchaîné was one that I preferred, I guess, which is the same kind of publication. How big, do you know roughly how big was it? Was it very popular in France, and what's going to happen to it?
Well, Sybil, that's interesting. It is not a big paper. It sells, on average, about 30,000 copies per week, which is very small.
Yeah.
So let's be very clear here. Not everybody reads Charlie Hebdo in France.
Yeah.
Some people think it's extremely funny. Some people think it's extremely bad taste. Some would not even consider opening it once in their life. That being said, for the vast majority of people, I think the fact that it exists, that a satirical weekly like this can exist, is a good sign. It's a good sign. I mean, even before anything happened, people would, when you go in the morning in Paris and you buy your Le Monde or Libération or Le Figaro in your newsstand, Charlie Hebdo is always there somewhere. It's part of the landscape. You don't necessarily buy it. Again, it's a small circulation, 30,000, really, really small. But it's really part, and I think most people, with a few minor exceptions, would say it's a good thing it's out there, even though I don't necessarily like it. So I think that's where... That's the background. That being said, what's going to come up next? You have to remember the major cartoonists, the major editors were killed in the attack, almost 10 of them. It'll be difficult to go forward. They have said there will be another issue coming out next week.
And
they're aiming at 1 million copies this time, just as a symbolic show of force and sending the message that it didn't kill Charlie Hebdo. So they're now hosted in another paper called Libération. They've received money from various organizations.
Oh, really?
So we'll definitely see another issue of Charlie Hebdo coming up next week.
Yeah. Well,
they got help from the government. Google is helping to kick in, and they say that they're... I found it amazing that they put out the statement the day after the shooting and the attack that said, we're putting out our paper. Like, it's coming out, and we're putting out this magazine. It's going to happen. It's going to happen next week. That's incredible to me.
You have to remember to receive them, tremendous support from all over the world with the Je Suis Charlie or Nous Sommes Charlie bit on Twitter or elsewhere. Mm-hmm. It's obviously quite unprecedented.
Yeah, a sign in front of the French embassy here in Washington, D.C., which President Obama visited yesterday when he came back yesterday evening. Nous sommes Charlie, nous sommes tous Charlie.
And he ended up with the Vive la France at the end of his
Yeah, that's right, he did that, right. Well, hey, Jerome, thanks so much for taking the time for us this morning. We'll catch you back up at the White House next week. Thanks, Jerome. Have a good weekend.
Thank you, Bill.
There he is, Jerome Cartillier. Does a great job covering the White House for Agence France-Presse. We'll be right back.
This is the Bill Press Show.
Tune into Free Speech TV for Democracy Now!, a national, independent, award-winning news program bringing you people and perspectives rarely seen on corporate media.
Grunt work. Love it, hate it, useful, not useful?
Necessary.
Our social entrepreneurs are people who have been on the front lines of social change. I've learned so much from talking with them. This is Cafe Impact, and I'm Jonathan Lewis.
I will say that I think is a challenge for anyone, especially the new workforce as they come in, is the ability to accept grunt work with grace.
The most boring, awful details are the most important elements of doing this work. From the way you save names in your Rolodex to the way you bank and you deposit checks. The truth is, this work isn't glamorous, it's rewarding. You don't go into this for the glamour, you go into it for the impact. And so it takes that determination to do the scut work to actually get anywhere.
It can be really challenging in a first job for someone who's coming out of finishing school to have the enthusiasm that they do to make the type of social impact that they've dreamed of. And now they're here in this first job and all of a sudden they're shouldered with all this grunt work and they don't understand and they don't get it and they're resentful.
Talk more about the power of answering phones.
I did that myself, you know, took out the trash, you know, cleaned offices when I had to, and it's all good. There's power in being a good team player and in being somebody who sometimes has to support other people's leadership before you get to have your own moment in the sun.
Is it hard to wait?
It is absolutely hard to wait, especially if you're an alpha female like I am.
I think grunt work can help a new employee build trust internally and teach them the nuances of how an organization is run so that they can have a real good sense of what HR is doing, what finance is doing, what all the other departments are, and that actually makes them a better employee in the long run.
So in my role on a daily basis, I literally can be looking at a new venture in software. Mm-hmm. We could be looking at a microfinance deal. I could be making coffee, taking out the trash, and riding a tractor on any given day.
Have you found people who thought it was demeaning that they were given this job, work in the front office and make the coffee when they graduated with all A's from this great university?
People like that just don't last very long in our world. If your approach to life is that, you know, you're so smart and you're such a fabulous entrepreneur that you can't understand why people aren't giving you opportunities, it's really hard to advance.
Tune into Gay USA with hosts Ann Northrup and Andy Hum for in-depth coverage of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender news. Watch Gay USA every week, only on Free Speech TV.
At Earth Justice, we defend the environment in the courtroom. Join our fight. When you take a seat, you take a stand. Earth Justice, because the Earth needs a good lawyer.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
All right, here we go. 26 minutes now after the hour. Big political news yesterday. When I was a Democratic state chair of California, one of the reasons that I agreed to become Democratic state chair of California in 1993 was because in 1992, California had just elected two of my good friends, both women, both from San Francisco, as members of the United States Senate. I worked in both of their campaigns. They've both been friends for a long time. Senator Dianne Feinstein, of course, and Senator Barbara Boxer. Think about it. That's three terms ago for Senator Boxer. She's up again in 2016, and yesterday she stunned the political world in California with this announcement.
Although I am not retiring from the issues and the work that I love, I won't be running for the Senate in 2016.
Not running for the Senate in 2016. And she said there's a very simple reason why she is not going to run.
The beauty of my not having to worry about myself and raising tens of millions for myself, which I have always not liked at all, I have an opportunity to help others.
She's going to help others, and she said, frankly, she just wants to go home. Caught Nancy Pelosi by surprise. Here's her reaction when a reporter asked her about, what do you think about Barbara Boxer retiring, as Nancy Pelosi finished her news conference?
What?
She's going to retire. Senator Boxer.
She called me before I came down here, and I came here. That's fine. She called me. She says she wanted to talk to me personally. I thought you wanted maybe have dinner tonight or something. Oh, my. Well, I, you know, her decision is an important one for her and her family.
I did her
it's
up
all
there,
personal
but
and
obviously
individual.
They've been very, very good friends
Boxer
for a long time.
Senator Boxer has been such a champion.
But she was caught by surprise because she didn't have a chance to talk to Barbara personally before that call. We'll come back to Kevin Barron from Defense One.
This is the Bill Press Show.
At Earth Justice, we defend the environment in the courtroom. Join our fight. When you take a seat, you take a stand. Earth Justice, because the Earth needs a good lawyer.
Tune in to Gay USA with hosts Ann Northrup and Andy Hum for in-depth coverage of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender news. Watch Gay USA every week, only on Free Speech TV.
What gets you into college? Good SAT scores? High GPA? Lots of extracurriculars?
Sure, but what you really need is money.
If you don't have the cash, you'll need a loan.
And we mean huge student loans, because the cost of college has risen 1,000% in the last 30 years.
This means big money for the banks that collect fees and interest.
Now, millions of young people are starting their adult lives with an average of $29,000 of loans on their backs.
Altogether, we're talking $1.2 trillion in student debt.
And more people are finding it impossible to pay them back. Welcome to the student debt crisis. The increasing demand for higher education and cuts to state funding gave colleges a huge incentive to keep inflating prices.
I graduated about a year ago, currently in $35,000 of debt.
I am in debt about like $25,000.
I owe $23,000.
I owe over $50,000 in student loans.
38.8 million Americans owe money on a student loan. And the biggest names in banking are making huge profits off the booming student loan industry. Sallie Mae, the largest provider of private student loans, made $949 million last year.
They only give you about 6 months to look for a job. You have to start paying like back the loan. Like it's very pressuring, especially nowadays. It's very hard to find a job.
Over half of the students graduating in 2012 could not find a decent paying job.
They either had low-wage jobs or unpaid internships or were unemployed altogether.
So you can't make the payments. You start incurring late fees, which makes the loan even harder to pay off.
And it stays with you for years, even decades.
Right now, a third of the people who started repaying their loans are delinquent or in default.
That's 13.7 million people, more than the populations of Chicago, New York, and San Francisco combined. Worse, it's not just the borrowers who are in trouble. Many loans require co-signers.
So if the student is unable to pay, that co-signer, a father, a mother, or a grandparent, is now on the hook.
Even a grandparent's Social Security benefits can be garnished to pay the loan.
We should have an answer to this. If you get really behind in your car payment or your credit cards, you can file for bankruptcy.
But Congress has made it nearly impossible to discharge student loans through bankruptcy.
Big institutions make big profits while students try to make ends meet under crushing debt.
Is this how we want our education system to work?
The whole point of going to college is to get the career you want, but lately that's been discouraged because no one can afford school. You get a job just to pay off your student loans.
We need higher education, not higher debt.
Sign up to end the student debt crisis at higheredndotdebt.org.
Connect with the Bill Press Show on Twitter. Follow us at BP Show and tweet using the hashtag WatchingBP. This is the Bill Press Show.
What do you say? 33 minutes after the hour now, Friday, January 9, the Bill Press Show. Booming out to you live from Washington, D.C. in our studio on Capitol Hill. It's cold in Washington these days and still a little snow on the ground. We're brought to you today by AFSCME, the largest public employee and healthcare workers union in the entire country. They're making America happen under President Lee Saunders. And for more information, just go to their website at AFSCME.org, AFSCME.org. We are still, the whole world, still watching as the two suspects in the brutal assassination of 10 journalists and two security officers at the offices of Charlie Hebdo magazine in Paris. Those two suspects have been surrounded, are now surrounded. They've taken one hostage. They're cornered in a small village outside of Paris, but it still raises questions about where are we on the so-called war on terror? Was this an organized effort? How do we combat this evil? Kevin Barron is here from Defense One, good friend of the program, maybe with some answers. Happy New Year, Kevin. Good to see you.
Happy New Year. Good to see you, too.
Did you have a good break?
Not bad. Yeah.
Did you get that little skiing trip in with your sons? I think right.
I left them behind and I went for myself.
Oh, right.
That's the way to do it.
They'll get to go out.
I was
out
hoping that's what you'd say.
No, yeah. I did test my old knee, but I think they'll get out next month.
I'll tell you one thing: the biggest, maybe the most fun, but the biggest mistake I made.
Having children.
Over the holidays, I meant to say. I was going sledding with my grandson. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How'd that turn out?
That's my back.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's my knee. I'm trying to see if I can ski this year because of a ski tubing accident last year.
Ski tubing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just say a skiing accident.
Skiing.
Just say a skiing accident.
Ski terrorism, actually. Did you see for your eyes only? Like the skis? It was like that.
This was a whiteout day. It was whiteout. It was snowing like mad, and it was a big hill. And I dragged the sled up to the top of the hill, and then I thought, I'm not going to walk down this hill. I'm going to sled down it. And I hopped on the sled on my back. I mean, one of these, like a board, you know. And there's a little jump. You couldn't see it.
Email Carol right now. I hope there's at least a photo, hopefully video.
There's not.
Ah, damn it.
No. I went airborne, and I landed flat on my back.
Mm.
Yeah, oh, so man. I am.
No. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, right. On the note of today's thing, what... I'm at a loss, you know. I mean, I understand political issues and you disagree on this, and I can see both sides of everything. I can't even comprehend where these terrorists are coming from with actions like this and what they intend to gain by it. I'm not saying that you can't either, but if you can't even understand where they're coming from, how do you deal with these people?
Well, I think that's a huge problem right there. Is if we can't figure out how to change mindsets, I mean, we're going to be doing a lot of fighting. I lived in Paris long ago, and I was there this summer. We went through with Secretary Hagel at the end of a long trip right over D-Day, and by good fortune, because Obama was there, the White House press corps was flown out for the D-Day festivities, but the Pentagon press corps was left behind in Paris.
Oh,
so unfortunately, I had 3 whole days to walk the city, and I hadn't been in a long time. And it was marvelous. And it's wonderful. It's Paris in June.
Oh, no.
And my thought then was...
I love that city.
Well, there's a point to this. I said that, on TV, there were lots of these old newsreels of World War II and of the era where the Nazis were marching down the Champs-Élysées for 4 years straight. And I went to the Arc de Triomphe, and I sat there, and you was reminded how, and I wrote about it, I was reminded how it's a massive war memorial, and etched into it are the names of all these battlefields and generals, and their Tomb of the Unknown Soldier and their Eternal Flame is right there. And I just had this thought that way, terrorism, it's the problem of our generation, it's the problem of our time, it is existential, it's this battle of ideas. But they're not going to march down the Champs-Élysées. It's different. There's not going to be battalions and brigades and formations mechanized divisions occupying that city for 4 years. Can you imagine what that must have been like? This is different. The city is still under maybe a psychological siege of some kind, and people are afraid of terrorism. But even this attack was a targeted attack, a retaliatory specific attack. It wasn't like 9/11 where they went after the buildings. They went after these giant symbols to cause havoc. Mm-hmm. But they did it, and they did it there. They were born there. They're from France. They tried to, they did go in and out of the Middle East for, training and association and affiliation. And they came back and they caused this violence there. Very targeted kind of a thing, but it happened. That's the big worry, I think, now, is if extremists want to call, fighters into Iraq and Syria, the U.S. is more than happy, it seems, to send our own fighters, or at least drones, and go help, more regional fighters, go have that war over there. That's the old Bush doctrine, right? Fight them over there before it gets here. Well, this is different. If the new version of it is, don't come here, stay where you are, and start that fight right where you are, you don't have to, Saudi Arabia or whoever, they don't have to, you don't have to send fighters from the Middle East into Paris. They're already there. They're already in London. They were in Ottawa this summer. So the next fear is, so how many of them are here? Right. How many of them are in the U.S.? How many are there not?
You're absolutely right. I mean, it is not limited to the Middle East anymore. I mean, yesterday, Scott Pelley last night on the CBS News, after spending half the broadcast talking about Paris and reporting on the latest, said, we just want to report that we're all talking about Paris. But he said, today, here are other terrorist attacks that happened yesterday. As I recall, right, I may be off a little bit, but I think like one was in Baghdad, one was in Nigeria with the Boko Haram, then in Yemen, and in each of those, there were more people killed than in Paris.
Yeah, the same day, there was the bombing in Yemen outside a police academy with 30 people on the street, a massive car bomb.
Right.
Right there. And that's, you know, that happens a lot.
Yeah.
It was Baghdad the next day.
And it's happening daily. It's happening, popping all around the world. But just like, what inspires these people? And again, what do they hope to gain by this methodology?
Nothing has changed.
Any recruits or adherents?
Sorry, guys. I just want to break in because there's some breaking news. There is another shooting in eastern Paris. At least one person is injured. They're not sure if they could connect this yet, but France 24, also BBC, reporting that another shooting, an armed man has reportedly taken a hostage at a kosher grocery store, again, in eastern Paris. So that's just now happening, and we're going to keep an eye on that.
All right. I want to point out that yesterday there was a woman shot somewhere near Paris, and they for a time they thought they may be connected. They were totally not connected to this.
Yeah.
Hopefully, it's the same situation.
I think
young people, as you point out, you know, leaving Europe, leaving the United States, volunteering, right, to go over there and fight with these ISIS fighters. Today it's ISIS, then yesterday it was Al Qaeda.
Right. I mean, you know, keep the big perspective, right? This is the extreme minority in one case, but it's nothing new.
Boy, the damage they can do.
Well, that's the point. Look, we've been talking for more than a decade now about this battle of ideology, and this has come up a lot since the summer. And you hear in the Pentagon, right? That's why I'm here. I'm a Pentagon reporter. And you hear these generals say over and over again, you can't kill your way to victory. It's got to be something bigger. There's this, you know, big sense of...
Do generals say that?
Sure. They say it all the time.
They know that.
They say verbatim all the time. It's a talking point. You can't kill your way to victory. Mm. You know, they want a more help off the gun to change minds, to change ways. But that's not their job. That's the rest of the government.
Yeah.
And, you know, I kept remembering, if at the end of the NATO summit last summer, they came out with this multi-point plan to attack ISIS. And one of the points was to go after the ideology. And I did something at the time where I said, what does NATO have to do with fighting ideology? You know, NATO's a military alliance. You know, if that's supposed to be the job of diplomats in the State Department or you know, the old USIA cultural institutions, something like that, where is it?
Mm-hmm.
Where is the battle? If it's not going to be American-led, I don't know who's going to do it. To change, and it's more than just hearts and minds. It's the idea of an entire region that's, stricken with all the problems that it has with unemployment and disenfranchisement and these horrible regimes that are just so oppressive, and the only alternative still only remains extremism. When is extremism going to be replaced by American Western democratization as the shining beacon on the hill? And if ever, and how? Where's the effort to do that?
It's the if ever that I was going to add. So Rand Paul got in a lot of trouble back in when he was running for president, one of the times at any rate, and opposing, we had him on the show several times, and making this point. He was opposing the invasion of Iraq and saying this is not the way to change the hearts and minds of people. It's just going to generate more terrorism, and we ought to be looking at our actions and what is it that we're doing that inspires some of these people to hate us. And remember, Rudy Giuliani at the time wanted to have him thrown out of all Republican debates for daring make that statement.
Right.
Been reported in the French press that this older brother of these two that are now cornered was turned from an average teenager to a radical extremist by the U.S. invasion of Iraq.
Well, yes, I've heard that too. I
mean, and he trained with this Al-Aliki, the cleric whom we killed with a drone.
Right, he did, and the younger brother was, you know, in jail, and you know, there are lots of reasons. We all know the political, you know, between the lines of all this, right? You can't say what Rand Paul did without being accused of somehow blaming all of America and America is nothing wrong.
Yeah.
And even Rand Paul has said there are times when he would support military intervention.
Sure.
You know, he's not a complete.
Yeah.
You know, he's not a commie pinko. But you can't have that. You can't have a debate. You can't even say that kind of thing. Even in this country where we're supposed to be the ones where we can debate everything. I think, the answer is probably like everything else in life, somewhere in between. We need intelligence officials and we need special forces and special operators and we need drone strikes and we need a lot of these tools that have been developed to continue to strike the terrorist organizations because they have worked in lots of cases. They've broken them up. They've taken out leaders. They've prevented violence. There's constant, many attacks we don't ever hear of because they're always being, thwarted or taken care of ahead of time. At the same time, though, is what we were just talking before, is the other side of the aisle.
We need more than that.
And, while at one time, when we're all lighting candles in vigil for this satirical newspaper, yet Egypt, our wonderful great ally, still holds Al Jazeera English and Western reporters in jail for being reporters.
Good point, right.
So, the country is not going to stop selling Egypt F-16s and tanks and anything else that they want and they need because Egypt is a pillar of security and stability in that region. And I say it over and over and over. The Pentagon and the military and the national security apparatus in Washington cares first and foremost about security and stability. They don't care about democracy. They don't care about the Arab Spring. That's another part of our government that's supposed to do that. But that's what the security guys think of.
Kevin Barron here from Defense One. I think we're going to, let's talk when we come back. I think this is never going to change. I mean, I'm on this issue.
Things change.
Well, good. Good. I'm glad you feel that way. Kevin Barron from Defense One, defenseone.com. Join the conversation here at 866-55-PRESS if you've got any answers. 866-55-77-377. We'll be right back.
This is the Bill Press Show.
Tune into Free Speech TV for Democracy Now!, a national, independent, award-winning news program bringing you people and perspectives rarely seen on corporate media.
I'm the retired bishop with the Episcopal Church as the bishop for all chaplains in federal service. I read that there was a group of people that represented a sense of injustice that I had. We'd lost Zuccotti. I mean, there was a kind of a hope that maybe Trinity Church would be gracious and give refuge. We picked this day where we would gather and demonstrate that Trinity was closing its ears to what was happening. We marched around the block, and I realized that, my goodness, they're carrying a ladder. And I thought, well, this is the moment. You could feel a spiritual presence. You could feel a certain something. And then the cops came in. It got brutal.
I'm with you right here, Robin. I'm here.
The church needed, in this moment in history, to stand alongside of these protesters. Truth of Christ is found in the pews, is found in the institutional church, but it is also found on the streets. It's found in the honesty and the integrity, the insistence of people that you find in Occupy Wall Street.
Tune in to Gay USA with hosts Ann Northrup and Andy Hum for in-depth coverage of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender news. Watch Gay USA every week, only on Free Speech TV.
What the frack?
What the frack?
What the frack?
What the frack?
President Obama, are you fracking kidding me?
Reopen the EPA studies.
In Texas, Wyoming, and Pennsylvania.
Fracking pollutes our oceans.
Fracking poisons our water.
Fracking makes climate change worse.
Fracking relies on toxic chemicals that cause cancer.
Ban fracking now.
Ban fracking now.
Go on. Ban it.
Ban fracking now.
Please.
Seen on Free Speech TV and online on TawkrTV. This is the Bill Press Show.
Here we go. Kevin Barron with us from Defense One, executive editor. That's DefenseOne.com. We'll take a look at the 114th Congress meeting for the first week, this week of 2015, with Burgess Everett from Politico at the top of the next hour. We were talking about the two suspects, talking about the whole case of how we deal with terrorism. These two suspects in Paris were both known to officials. One of them had served some prison time. The police knew who they were as soon as they found their ID card. ID, right? Yeah. Oh, God, those two brothers. They were on the U.S. no-fly list, right?
Mm-hmm.
So shouldn't they maybe have been better monitored? Is it?
Yeah,
fair?
I don't know what the deal is. I mean, we were talking earlier. I'm a Pentagon reporter. I cover the military, so I'm unfamiliar with the extent of, what does it take? How many guys are on these lists, and how many people are watched, and how many are in Paris and in Frankfurt and all that? And I think the country doesn't understand that, partly because this is how we cover.
There are probably thousands on the list. Is that it?
But I mean, this is journalism. We have there's a few dozen Pentagon reporters, and there's even less than that who cover the Justice Department and terrorism and international terrorism. And there are even few reporters who really know the networks of terrorism that are out there. We have 1,000 reporters on the Hill covering politics in this town, but not this world. So it's a little underappreciated and under understood. Is that a word? It is now.
Misunderstood.
Misunderestimated. Thank you.
Yeah.
Misunderestimated.
That's why you're on that. That's why you're in that chair and I'm in this chair. but I think it's about time we do understand a lot more of it because if this is the new era and this is the future, sure we're going to have battlefields to cover like Iraq and Syria and Afghanistan and who knows where else. But really, the fight across that region and the one that we're seeing today that's bled into Paris and into London and it will into who knows where. And I'm sure one day we're going to be talking about it here in the U.S. It's not a military fight anymore. Then it's an intelligence fight. It's a counterterrorism. It's going to be the FBI and DOJ and all these other places.
But at some point, it has to be a persuasion fight, right? I mean, just to convince them that it doesn't have to be the United States of America form of democracy, but that some form of democracy and freedom of expression, like the freedom in question here, is preferable to Sharia lifestyle.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure it's got to be some factor of time and influence and money and you name it. I think often about the story of the IRA. I mean, when I first came onto the Pentagon beat a while back,
right.
A book had come out about all the, it was basically about the history of IEDs.
Yeah.
And the author said that at the time, he goes, you might as well call them Irish explosive devices because they were using them in the 1800s. And this new phenomenon that to Americans in the Iraq War, there was a lot of experience with the Brits and the Irish. If you remember, the Americans actually went to the British authorities and the British military for help of how do you break this up. And it was them that said, well, you got to go after the networks. Forget about the actual devices. Go after the networks behind them and break those up, the cause of it. But there are still a few guys who call themselves IRA, and they probably always will be for some, just like ETA and all some of these other groups. But they're not what they used to be, right? Times changed. Don't be such a pessimist. At some point, something will change, and times, this is just like we see these pictures of Afghanistan in the 60s where it looked pretty hip and cool, back in the day. It looks a lot different now. Well, we'll see what happens in 50 years, but there's got to be an effort. It's got to be purposeful.
I mean, I'm glad you raised that point. That's the most positive thing I've heard all day and the most positive thought I've had in the last couple of days.
Well, that's what I do. I rain positivity wherever I go.
No, but I mean, I remember when everybody figured that the IRA, they would be, and that fight would be going on.
The Troubles.
Forever, the Troubles, forever and ever, and look where we are today. So this, too,
you know.
This too shall pass? Or
this too shall pass, I guess. All right.
Well,
and
we'll
I'll tell you, this half hour has passed very fast and very well. Kevin, aww, thanks to you. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
All right. See you often in 2015, we hope.
I hope so, and I promise, I guess I'll bring the donuts next time.
All right. Defense1.com, Kevin Barron. Thanks.
This is the Bill Press Show.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
A few years ago, plastic bag waste in our city came to a tipping point. It was clear. We had a bag problem. My department was tasked to reduce plastic bag consumption. We needed to come up with ways to change human behavior. So we asked ourselves,
should I get by?
What do people really hate?
Yep.
Getting punched in the stomach. Preliminary studies showed that the consequences weren't severe enough to warrant behavioral change.
Actually, can I get that double bagged?
So we thought, what do people hate more than getting punched in the stomach? Kissing Helga.
Hey, big boy.
People didn't find her so offensive after all, so we had to get creative.
How many bags? Okay, now pour this ice water down your pants.
We tried everything.
Eat this rat.
Defuse this bomb.
Even fighting your clone. After blowing through millions of dollars of government funds on research, I came up with a brilliant idea.
Why don't we just charge 5 cents per bag?
That's a stupid idea.
Would you like a bag?
Yes.
5 cents a bag.
5 cents? 5 cents? Do I still have the option of getting punched?
Honestly, I don't know how everyone else missed it.
Why don't you just get a reusable bag?
This is the Bill Press Show.
Okay, Burgess Everett from Politico joining us at the top of the next hour. And then John McQuaid, author of a new book called Tasty, will be along at the half hour. President Obama's big event today down in Knoxville, Tennessee, at the Pellissippi State Community College, if you will, where he's going to propose a great, great idea. 2 years, the first 2 years of community college free for every student in America. I love it. Good move, Mr. President. We need more of that.
This is the Bill Press Show.
Now, one of the biggest uncertainties in climate science right now is the role of clouds.
What better way to work that part out than flying right through them? That's what NASA scientists aboard this airplane think. Welcome to NASA's biggest airborne laboratory. You're coming with us today on an 8-hour NASA flight mission.
When you read these big IPCC climate assessments, what's the biggest uncertainty? There's two, right? The role of aerosols and how and clouds. Clouds is probably bigger than aerosols.
That is a piece of a puzzle that right now we are missing.
You can't get the models right if you don't understand the chemistry and the process.
Now we're being told we've got to get on. The doors are about to shut, so let's go aboard. Every time you turn on the weather, every time you hear a climate change prediction, that information has to come from somewhere. And it starts by getting sucked out of the air from planes like this.
So this mission is to particularly try to understand the emissions from the surface, or mostly biogenic emissions, so from trees and other plants.
Right now we're flying to our very first part of this experiment on the DC-8. Over Arkansas, there's a particularly pungent bouquet of emissions that scientists are interested in measuring.
Well, these emissions lead to both aerosols and to molecules that both destroy and create ozone. So these are very important things to understand for climate studies.
How it will manifest itself, it will be in more accurate and more reliable predictions.
So what we're doing is taking a series of flyovers, each at a different level of the atmosphere, scooping up those emissions, testing them, and hopefully scientists are going to see exactly what's in this column of air all the way up.
The data that we collect in one flight can keep busy 60 scientists and students for 3 years, 4 years. We're still studying data from data collected 20 years ago.
In fact, this particular mission today is its most heavily equipped in its nearly 30 years of service. Each one of these consoles here is a specially equipped scientific instrument designed to collect all sorts of different data in real time.
And this instrument here tracks the sun.
We're looking at mist chambers. They're used to strip soluble gases.
This black line is the CO2. About 390 ppm right now.
We're putting these filters in the bags that we've got the aerosols that we trapped out of a certain amount of air. And so we're sampling up here about 150 liters a minute.
That ultimately flows back into the operational models. It flows back into what goes on TV every day.
Anyway, I gotta get this sample going.
You do it. It's a busy man at work. We can't let him rest. Well, get this, we've just spent 2 hours crisscrossing this one cloud formation, in, back out again, back in again.
Then they grow, and we track them as long as we can, and then we let it go.
Even one cloud can hold a host of answers to the mysteries of climate change.
The patterns of, you know, where the clouds are, what type of clouds we see, what kind of weather systems they're associated with, it, that'll all be shifting in a shifting climate, in a world with climate change.
And the big spark is this, is when we actually get the meat on the grill. And then it will be some time to process it.
Issue on this planet right now is to protect and conserve biodiversity in the world's oceans. And I don't think people realize just how intimate our connection is with the oceans themselves. Not only do they provide the very foundation of life and control our weather, but life just simply could not exist without a healthy ocean. The real problem, though, is apathy. It's all out of sight, it's all out of mind, and people don't even think about it. But it doesn't matter whether you live in Peoria or on the coast. The fact is, whatever happens in the ocean affects all life forms on the planet Earth. If the oceans die, then civilization collapses. We all die. We cannot live on this planet without the oceans. This is, in fact, not the planet Earth. It's the planet ocean. But because we're a land-dwelling species, we refer to it as Earth. But it is the planet ocean, and the oceans are the heart and the foundation of all life on the planet.
What the frack?
What the frack?
What the frack?
President Obama, are you fracking kidding me?
Reopen the EPA studies.
In Texas, Wyoming, and Pennsylvania.
Fracking pollutes our oceans.
Fracking poisons our water.
Fracking makes climate change worse.
Fracking relies on toxic chemicals that cause cancer.
Ban fracking now.
Ban fracking now.
Go on. Ban it.
Ban fracking now.
Please.
Two anti-government, self-described revolutionaries have shot up a pizza restaurant as well as a Walmart in Las Vegas.
The internationally syndicated political series, The David Pac-Man Show, provides progressive talk, analysis, and interviews with the nation's youngest radio and television host, David Pac-Man. Find out more and catch up on all the latest episodes by visiting our website at freespeech.org.
Broadcasting around the nation, on your radio, on your TV, and online. This is the Bill Press Show.
All right, you heard it from everybody else. Now you hear it from me for the first time. Happy New Year. My first chance to say so because it's my first day back, as you know. But it's good to be back here. Bill Press with you this Friday, January 9. Indeed, hope you had a great holiday season and wish you all the best for 2015. I had missed you the first 4 days here, but you would not have wanted to hear me or see me. I was in pretty bad shape, but a hell of a lot better today. This Friday, lots to talk about. Coming to you live from Washington, D.C. Actually, Congress in town, at work, got some things done this week. The president has been on the road for the last 2 days and on the road again today with a big announcement about community colleges. We'll also keep you up to date on any news, breaking news out of the hunt for the two terrorist suspects in just outside of Paris. They are now surrounded and cornered in a house there. They have taken a hostage, and the police are closing in. It's only a matter of time before we see the end of that particular chapter in this war on terror, or whatever we want to call it. Thank you again for joining us on your local Progressive Talk radio station, where you happen to be. It's good to have you with us in Radio Land, and thank you for joining us on Free Speech TV. It's Monday. Right?
Monday.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Free Speech, this third hour you will be seeing today on Free Speech TV by delay at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific. On Monday, that's going to change till 5 Eastern and 2 Pacific. But thank you for being there and worldwide on our video stream, TawkrTV. Good to see you as well. YouTube.com/TawkrTV. We got the whole team here to start off the year. Peter Ogburn and Lisa Murphy.
Hey, Bill.
Hey, good morning. Happy Friday.
What do you say? With Alish Cruz there on the phones. And Cyprian Balding, as always, keeping us looking good on the video stream and on Free Speech TV. Congress is back in town. Burgess Everett is back at work for Politico, keeping track of these guys to the extent that anybody can. Hello, Burgess.
Hey,
nice to see you. Happy New Year.
Thanks, same to you.
You had a good holiday, I hope?
Yeah, everything was good.
All right. Do you know, the president this week had a very, very important visitor. The president of Mexico was in town. They had a big summit meeting. And there's nothing like the Pope yesterday. The Pope had a very, very important visitor, very extraordinary visitor. And as Conan O'Brien last night pointed out, she got a big reaction out of the Pope.
Today, Angelina Jolie met with Pope Francis at the Vatican.
How about that?
Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
Angelina Jolie met Pope Francis. After she left, Pope Francis was overheard saying, "Damn!"
Damn!
Damn!
Love that.
Yeah, that's good. Right,
you can just see the Pope saying that to her.
That's the universal language, by the way. You don't have to speak Italian or English or whatever, right? Latin, it translates.
I think she was trying to adopt him, actually.
Right.
That's right. Yeah. She only has 9 now, yeah. Right? Okay. We got it. Burgess Everett here for the first half hour. And then we're going to talk about food and how we acquire a taste for different foods and different peoples acquire different tastes for different foods. Fascinating subject. John McQuaid is the author of a new book called Tasty. He'll be joining us in studio. Is he bringing samples along?
Oh, I should have asked him about that.
That'll be a big tease.
I'll be acquiring my own market lunch after this.
There you go.
I mean, really, the only reason I got out of my sick bed to come in today is because I thought the guy was going to bring food with him. So, and I just realized that
he writes about food. He doesn't cook food, but
he doesn't have to cook it. He can buy it.
Nice.
All right. And anyway, all of that coming up, but first, Peter.
This is the Full Court Press.
Just a couple of other stories making news. Charlie Hebdo normally has a printing run of about 50,000 copies. That's the run of the magazine when it normally prints. They announced the day after the shooting in Paris, the attack, that they would publish next week. Yeah. January 14th will be the next edition, which is a pretty amazing feat. And they're going to get a little bit of help from some friends. First of all, the French government and Google. They are kicking in big time money to help them print over 1 million copies of the magazine. So they're going to have a lot of them out on the street. You can expect that even though they're doing about 1 million copies, it will still sell out, I'm sure.
It will.
That'll be a collector's item to me.
Yeah.
That's a total collector's item. Yeah.
Good
for them, by the way.
Yeah.
That's I saw somebody say this, that the real answer to this attempt to silence people is that more people publish the same cartoons. They said they can't kill millions and millions of people.
Right. Yeah, there you go. When you fly, are you ever annoyed by people who get on with their pets? I know the answer for you, Bill. The answer is a big yes.
I'm annoyed by people who get on with their children, first of all. And then their pets.
So I can only imagine how you feel about pets.
Right.
Do you ever have a problem with people get on with their pets?
Yeah, the personal comfort pet thing.
Yeah.
Which apparently can go as far as bringing a pig or whatever.
I mean,
anything.
Yeah. Well, there's a new survey done out of brand in Chicago, the GO Airport Express. It's a Chicago-based transportation company. They found out that 52% of U.S. adults responded a resounding yes when asked if animals should be if they have a problem with animals being allowed in the cabin. So the majority of travelers do have a problem with animals on the plane, but not like a large majority, just 52%.
No. By the way, I want to respond, but I just have to. I'm sorry. I forgot to introduce you at the top of the hour, I think.
No, I got it.
You got it?
Did
you
I get it?
Yeah.
I just thought maybe I hadn't.
Yeah.
I'm a little rusty because I haven't been as my first day back.
This is your first day back in 2015.
You didn't include me in the whole team, but I got kind of a second.
No, I meant to include you in the whole team.
Look, here's the thing. On Friday, Bill's hammered by the third hour. Okay. So Bill's very, very drunk, just to be clear.
This guy over here, this is Burgess Everett from Politico, covers Congress for Politico. Okay, back to your point. If somebody comes in with a little dog or a cat in a carry box or something, I'm fine with that. You put it under the seat, you never hear from it, fine. But anything bigger, anything, no.
I
sent it to a woman, as long as they're not in my row.
I sent next to a woman who had a cat under the seat in front of her not that long ago, and she spent the whole time talking to the cat. It's like a 3.5-hour flight. She's just chit-chatting with the cat. Better the cat than me,
frankly, but still. Yeah, I'd rather have her talk to the cat than me. Right?
Maybe this is a story for me to report out. You know, Congress could do something about that.
There you go. There you go. I'm giving you some ideas. And congratulations to Michael Sam. You remember when he was originally drafted, there was a shot of him hugging and giving a kiss to a his boyfriend. That man is Vito Camasiano. Well, they just recently became engaged. They are going to get married. Sam is still not playing in the NFL.
I was just going to say, what Sam needs is not
a husband. So he's got an employment issue.
He needs a job.
Yeah, exactly. But they are getting married, so congratulations to them. He is engaged.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see where he ends up.
We thank you. Now, just another guy here I forgot to introduce. Burge, it's good to see you. We've seen... They're sworn in now. They're back.
Right.
The new Congress 2050. It was a big effort to topple John Boehner. How'd that work out?
It didn't work out so well for the rebels against the establishment. 25 people voted not for Boehner. Well, one
but
person.
Isn't that a record number of people to...
So I was talking about this in the Capitol, and some people were saying, were writing that, you know, this was the biggest insurgency since the Civil War or something like that. Well, that's not really true, considering Newt Gingrich was toppled less than 20 years ago. So it wasn't the same, procedural voting him down on the Senate on the House floor. But I mean, that was a much bigger deal than this was this week.
Sure. Yeah. And these are Tea Party members, basically, right? Who thinks Boehner's too close to Obama?
Yeah, they're worried.
Make a deal. Is
I mean, they really want him to oppose the president, take a hard line on literally everything, which is not how you're going to keep the government funded. Even the bare minimum it would be impossible to do that. And they are very incensed about that spending bill in December, which did not attack the immigration executive order shielding millions of people from deportation.
So can they vote against the speaker with impunity?
So two people, one who ran for speaker against Boehner, Daniel Webster, were kicked off the Rules Committee, but there's some talk about adding the other person, Rich Nugent, back on. So Boehner's definitely weighing this right now, but it seems right now that he's leaning towards not punishing them too hard. It's just not really his style.
Yeah. Well, in fact, he's been called... Several people have called him different adjectives to describe him because he has not been willing to stand up to the Tea Party. Here is the speaker yesterday referencing that.
It does pain me to be described as spineless or a squish. And I tell you what pains me the most is when they describe me as the establishment.
And, you know, before that, he described himself as the most anti-establishment speaker in the history of the House, and he pointed to how he led the charge to get rid of earmarks.
Right.
So, which is not in dispute. You could certainly make an argument that maybe he's more establishment than another speaker, but the earmark thing is a good. I mean, this was a regular order involved earmarks 10 years ago. You know, and they're completely off the board at this point.
Right. No, he does get credit for that. At the same time. If John Boehner is not an establishment politician, he's not part of the Republican establishment, I'm not saying that's a bad thing.
Right.
I'm just saying...
The speaker, by definition, is the establishment, right?
Yeah. And so is Mitch McConnell, and so is Jeb Bush. I mean, you know, Ted Cruz isn't, I would say, right?
Well, says he's not, but at some point, everybody's the establishment the longer you're in Republican politics, right?
That's,
I mean, it's a very... I try to avoid using that term when I describe people in the Republican Party because many people take it as an insult, and it's just such a broad brush, you know? It's like calling someone a hipster almost.
Yeah. So I want to discuss something with you. I was on an interview, being interviewed the other day about this, and the guy started out by saying, boy, you got to be depressed these days. You know, Congress is back in town and the Republicans control both houses. I mean, you must, you know. And I said, no, I'm not really that depressed, and I'll tell you why. I believe the ingredients are there. Look, I'd rather Democrats control both houses. Fine. But I think the ingredients are there to get some things done this year.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to lay this out quickly and see if you think I'm totally crazy. Mitch McConnell, like his politics or not, is a consummate wheeler dealer. So is John Boehner, if you let John Boehner be John Boehner.
Right.
And so is Barack Obama. And I think both sides want to get, no, they've got to get some things done in the next 2 years. They can't go into 2016, Democrats, and blame everything on Republican obstructionism, and Republicans blame everything on Obama, you know?
Right.
So I think the potential, the ingredients are in place if they're willing to make it work.
I think you're correct, but I think they're definitely going to have to choose their spots, and there's a limited amount of time, in my opinion. By the fall of this year, everybody's going to be concentrating on the presidential race. Yesterday, it became apparent that the Iowa straw poll is going to happen in August, which draws so much attention to the presidential race.
This August.
Yeah. So you can already kind of see the calendar shaping up, right? So I think that there's room for one, maybe two major deals of some sort. I don't know which ones in particular, but you know, the idea of cooperating on these little piecemeal bills that the Republican Congress is starting off with, like the Keystone XL pipeline, yeah, and like redefining the work week under Obamacare, and maybe those could be tacked on to something, a spending bill later. But you know, we're not going to see like wheeling and dealing on every individual component that the Congress takes up.
The medical device tax, repeal of the medical device tax, is not the horse that Republicans can ride into 2016.
No,
I agree.
And then it'll blow the hole through the budget. And, you know, it's been interesting to watch.
They've got to choose their battles.
Totally. I mean, they'll still pass these things. But then the question is, well, how hard a line are you going to take it? Are you going to say, we're not going to pass a spending bill that doesn't include the Keystone Pipeline, things like that? These decisions haven't been made yet, but that's how these little piecemeal things would eventually become laws, by jamming it down the president's throat, because he's made pretty clear this week that he's going to use his veto pen to block stuff he doesn't like.
Burgess Everett is here with us from Politico. We're talking the 114th session of Congress, now underway. 866-55-PRESS. Your questions, your comments. Join the conversation. We'll be right back.
This is the Bill Press Show.
Tune into Free Speech TV for Democracy Now!, a national, independent, award-winning news program bringing you people and perspectives rarely seen on corporate media.
Grunt work. Love it? Hate it? Useful? Not useful?
Necessary.
Our social entrepreneurs are people who have been on the front lines of social change. I've learned so much from talking with them. This is Cafe Impact, and I'm Jonathan Lewis.
I will say that I think is a challenge for anyone, especially the new workforce as they come in, is the ability to accept grunt work with grace.
The most boring, awful details are the most important elements of doing this work. From the way you save names in your Rolodex to the way you bank and you deposit checks. The truth is, this work isn't glamorous, it's rewarding. You don't go into this for the glamour, you go into it for the impact. And so it takes that determination to do the scut work to actually get anywhere.
It can be really challenging in a first job for someone who's coming out of finishing school to have the enthusiasm that they do to make the type of social impact that they've dreamed of. And now they're here in this first job, and all of a sudden they're shouldered with all this grunt work. And they don't understand, and they don't get it, and they're resentful.
Talk more about the power of it. Answering phones.
I did that myself, you know, took out the trash, you know, cleaned offices when I had to, and it's all good. There's power in being a good team player and in being somebody who sometimes has to support other people's leadership before you get to have your own moment in the sun.
Is it hard to wait?
It is absolutely hard to wait, especially if you're an alpha female like I am.
I think grunt work can help a new employee build trust internally and teach them the nuances of how an organization is run, so that they can have a real good sense of what HR is doing, what finance is doing, what all the other departments are, and that actually makes them a better employee in the long run.
So in my role on a daily basis, I literally can be looking at a new venture in software. Mm-hmm. We could be looking at a microfinance deal. I could be making coffee, taking out the trash, and riding a tractor on any given day.
Have you found people who
thought it was demeaning that they were given this job, work in the front office and make the coffee when they graduated with all A's from this great university.
And, yeah, people like that just don't last very long in our world. If your approach to life is that, you know, you're so smart and you're such a fabulous entrepreneur that you can't understand why people aren't giving you opportunities, it's really hard to advance.
Tune in to Gay USA with hosts Ann Northrup and Andy Hum for in-depth coverage of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender news. Watch Gay USA every week, only on Free Speech TV.
At Earth Justice, we defend the environment in the courtroom. Join our fight. When you take a seat, you take a stand. Earth Justice, because the Earth needs a good lawyer.
This is the Bill Press Show.
Why do we eat what we eat? John McQuaid has a new book out called Tasty, which has some of the answers. He'll join us at the half hour. Right now we're talking congressional matters with Burgess Everett from Politico. Burgess, the House did pass one bill this year, or this week, rather. Mm-hmm. They only passed one last year, but no, one this week. On terrorism insurance, what's that all about?
Yeah, that's about insuring commercial buildings against terrorist attacks. That lapsed at the end of last year. It was kind of Tom Coburn, who is now retired. It was his last stand. He prevented swift consideration of that bill, so the Harry Reid decided to adjourn the Senate rather than spend 4 to 5 days trying to pass it at the end of the year. So the House passed it on Wednesday, the Senate passed it yesterday, and now it's on to the president's desk, the first law of the new Congress.
With the president says he will sign.
He will
correct?
Sign it, yes.
Yeah. I forget the exact number, but it passed the House the first time with overwhelming number of Democratic and Republican votes, right? I mean, this just says that it came out of 9/11, obviously.
Right. And a separate bill passed the Senate earlier last year overwhelmingly as well. This ended up just being about the fun in covering the Senate every day is one senator can hold everything up, and it gives every individual senator a ton of power, and Tom Coburn was very skilled at exercising that power when he wanted to.
Speaking of one senator, news yesterday that Senator Barbara Boxer, my good friend from California, is not going to seek a fourth term in the Senate. Does that come as a surprise?
Well, you know, we were talking about this a little in the break, and it's not a surprise for people in California. I was a little surprised at the way she decided to announce it. It's almost this is the kind of new way to announce your retirement is to figure out how not to let the media scoop you, and that's to put out something yourself, which was a 3-minute video she did with her grandson. So I don't think I was surprised, but she's a very feisty, energetic politician. She doesn't seem to be losing her enthusiasm for the job, so only in the sense that she still seems pretty engaged in the day-to-day matters of Congress was I surprised.
Yeah.
She's not checked out or anything.
No. Yeah. And she's not going to check out for the next 2 years. She's not resigning as of now, right? She's just saying she's not going to run for re-election.
But once you do that, you lose your juice a little bit in terms of, you know, people are more concerned with members who are coming back and things like that. So it's interesting she got it off her chest so early at the beginning of the Congress.
She is one of the great fighters for consumers and environmentalists and women and generally working Americans in the United States Senate, and has done a great job, I believe, representing the people of California. Burgess Everett, thanks for being with us today.
Thanks for having me.
See you again soon.
This
Happy New Year.
Is the Bill Press Show.
This is my computer.
This is your computer. Let's go on the internet.
Let's go. Click it.
Yes.
Okay.
I cursor in between the R and the E. guess he got him with a message delivery.
She's gonna love me all over again.
That's it. Jamaica, here you go.
Here we go.
Good job. Right.
Thank you. Thank you. And I did it by myself. Feel smarter.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
Same time next week?
Well, of course.
Put away a few bucks, feel like a million bucks. For free tips to help you save, go to
Feed the Pig.
All right. I know this isn't any fun to talk about, but we should. Okay. So who's going to do what?
I'll pack the dead batteries.
Great.
I'll only put what I don't need into a duffel bag.
Perfect. That's totally unhelpful.
No problem.
Meanwhile, I will try to comfort everyone by speaking in a calm voice.
And I'll try to get the generator going without any gas.
Oh, let's not forget the cell phones, which probably won't work.
Right.
And who is going to handle supplies?
I can forget to do a list for us.
Thanks, pal.
Well, I think we couldn't be any less prepared. I'm proud of you guys.
Talk to your kids about who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information.
Hey, thanks for stopping by. You know, I followed your character since the first episode. I'm a big fan. Big fan.
Thank you.
And listen, your storyline, it makes for incredible TV drama. Thing is, your drug use is very adult content. Too adult for the kids. So I'm gonna have to block you. Well, have a good one.
You're a nice lady.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
Hey, here we go now. 34 minutes after the hour. We thought we'd end up the week with something that we can all agree on. We all like to eat. The question is, why do we like to eat what we like to eat? Why do we like the taste of certain foods and not other foods? And why do Americans like certain foods or Europeans that Africans don't or whatever, or people in India don't? John McQuaid has a journalist living here nearby Washington in Silver Springs, has explored all these questions and put them together in a new book that's not even out yet, but will be by the time you get to your bookstore, maybe. Comes out Tuesday. They probably already have it in the bookstores.
Probably, yes.
At least, as an author, I say, John, I hope they do. That's, first mistake an author makes is, or a publisher can make, is put all the publicity out there before the book's in the bookstores. So I got that advice early on. John McQuaid, again, is with us. He's the author of The Art and Science of What We Eat, or just simply Tasty, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist. John, it's good to see you.
Thank you for having me.
How is taste acquired? I mean, from childhood, I guess, right?
We
eat what our parents like to eat? No?
It's really a lifelong process. It changes throughout the course of your lifetime. Children, it changes constantly. Part of it's genetic, obviously, like everything. Certain preferences, like a dislike for bitter tastes, that's programmed by your genes. A sweet tooth that is particularly pronounced in children. They think that has some sort of evolutionary benefit, so they like to get the sugar. Children are also picky eaters. My children, when they were younger in particular, would only eat certain foods, and they differed completely.
Oh, God. That all children are picky, aren't they, do you think?
Many, if not most.
I have two kids, two boys, and one will eat absolutely anything, and the other hates everything. So they are two completely opposite ends of the spectrum. Like Magnus, my youngest, he despises chocolate. He hates chocolate. He hates everything. He likes peanut butter sandwiches. That's it. My oldest, put anything in front of him, he'll eat it. He loves it.
Yeah, so, it's arbitrary because, kids, their brains are very plastic. They're changing all the time. From an evolutionary standpoint, people think perhaps that picky eating was a protective function, that, if you have hunter-gatherers wandering, you don't want kids popping anything into their mouth.
Yeah.
So that's possible. But, it drove me crazy with my kids because they were picky eaters and they had completely different tastes. My son liked and still likes really hot foods, like super hot peppers, spicy foods. He would like sour things, like limes. He would eat entire limes. And my daughter would like very bland foods, like comfort foods, like macaroni and cheese and pasta, rice, and things like that. So, and she hated the things that her brother liked.
We have five grandchildren, and with three of them, brothers and sisters, their favorite food is broccoli. They think broccoli is like a box of candy. You'd have to point a gun to my head to get me to eat broccoli. It's not that bad, but all I'm saying is I would never order broccoli. If it came on a plate as a side that I hadn't ordered, I probably would nibble at it. But
that's highly unusual.
For kids,
Yeah.
Well, that's an interesting thing about your dislike of broccoli, right? Like, is that something that is just a personal taste thing, or is that something that's wired into us? Because there are studies and stories out there about, cilantro is probably the most divisive thing out there. Some people love it, some people hate it. And there was a study not that long ago that said it's all a chemical thing. It's all like we are registered to either like it or dislike it. It's not our choice.
Yeah, it's genetic. the broccoli thing. It has to do with your bitter taste genes. Certain people are programmed to be very sensitive to bitter, bitter chemicals, and so they do not like broccoli or Brussels sprouts or other types of vegetables.
So it's not your fault, Bill. You're just born that way.
Right. Well, it sounds like then we sort of everybody works this out for himself or herself, right? That you may not, you're not given a chart ahead of time as to here's what your genetic makeup is, and so therefore here are the foods that you should be eating because these are the ones you're going to like. By trial and error, we figure it out, right?
Right, and we're also our brains and palates are very plastic. You know, over time, you can learn to like almost anything. So some people, or many people, in fact, start out not liking the taste of beer, for example, and later, which also has a very bitter taste, and over time develop a taste for it, or broccoli also. Partly as you age, you become less sensitive, but partly, you know, your brain rewires itself literally to learn to like something that it didn't before. Mm-hmm. This is part of why cuisine is so complicated. It has all these contradictory elements to it.
Okay. So I grew up in northern Delaware eating muskrat. Okay. Have you ever had muskrat?
No.
All right. Would you eat muskrat?
Yeah, I'd give it a try. What does it taste like? I mean,
tastes like chicken, as they say.
Swamp chicken.
As they say, right. No, it has a strong native taste to it, let's say.
Okay. Well, if it were grilled, seasoned properly.
But good. But good. Yeah. Now, at the same time, I wouldn't eat possum or squirrel or raccoon. Now, why not?
I've eaten all three. They're not that bad.
Well, you're from the South. which gets to my point, I guess. Isn't a lot of taste geographic? Where you grow up determines what you eat and what you like.
Totally, because we live with people who are eating the same things, and that kind of sets you on a certain course, and that's what you become accustomed to. It's totally arbitrary, though, if you took the same person and, planted them somewhere else for a number of years, and they would learn to like the local food there. It's why this also has to do with our background, our evolutionary background as hunter-gatherers. You know, people colonized the entire planet and lived in all these different habitats, and they learned to like all these different wild foods, many of which tasted terrible at first, no doubt, if you're coming into a new area. But then, you settle down, you got to live there, so you learn to like it.
I just want to ask this question about the struggle between parent and child, which every parent has gone through and every child has gone through, of you're going to eat what's put in front of you, end of story, as opposed to
cleaning
your plate, as opposed to making a separate meal for someone, for a kid, because they don't like whatever you've made or whatever. What's the answer there? Is it worth having the fight of eating what's in front of you, or is it just something that kids can't control?
Probably not. I mean, and in fact, that's sort of an antiquated tradition, really.
Yeah.
Because 50 or 100 years ago, scientists thought, well, basically everybody has the same tastes, and kids are just being kids. They have to be, they have to toe the line, and you have to make them toe the line with food, as with everything else. And now we know that everybody does have different tastes, and these strong preferences among kids, you can't just force them to change. And in fact, I never really was able to force my kids to eat anything they didn't like. They just wouldn't eat it. So, but eventually, they're teenagers now, and they're learning to like more things. So eventually, it changes.
Right. The book is Tasty. It will be in your local bookstores by Tuesday. Tuesday's the official publication date, but check it out already. You can certainly already buy it on Amazon, Amazon.com. We will have a link up on our website at BillPressShow.com. John McQuaid is here with us, book Tasty. We'll continue our conversation. You're welcome to join us. We'll find you a seat at the table at 866-55-PRESS, and we'll be right back.
This is the Bill Press Show.
Tune into Free Speech TV for Democracy Now!, a national, independent, award-winning news program bringing you people and perspectives rarely seen on corporate media.
I'm the retired bishop with the Episcopal Church as the bishop for all chaplains in federal service. I read that there was a group of people that represented a sense of injustice that I had. We'd lost Zuccotti. I mean, there was a kind of a hope that maybe Trinity Church would be gracious and give refuge. We picked this day where we would gather and demonstrate that Trinity was closing its ears to what was happening. We marched around the block, and I realized that, my goodness, they're carrying a ladder. And I thought, well, this is the moment. You could feel a spiritual presence. You could feel a certain something. And then the cops came in. It got brutal.
Yeah, I'm with you right here, Robin, I'm here.
The church needed, in this moment in history, to stand alongside of these protesters. The truth of Christ is found in the pews, is found in the institutional church, but it is also found on the streets. It's found in the honesty and the integrity, the insistence of people that you find in Occupy Wall Street.
Tune in to Gay USA with hosts Ann Northrup and Andy Hum for in-depth coverage of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender news. Watch Gay USA every week, only on Free Speech TV.
What the frack?
What the frack?
What the frack?
What the frack?
President Obama, are you fracking kidding me?
Reopen the EPA studies.
In Texas, Wyoming, and Pennsylvania.
Fracking pollutes our oceans.
Fracking poisons our water.
Fracking makes climate change worse.
Fracking relies on toxic chemicals that cause cancer.
Ban fracking now.
Ban fracking now.
Go on. Ban it.
Ban fracking now.
Please.
On your radio, on TV, and online, this is the Bill Press Show.
13 minutes before the top of the hour, some breaking news, Peter, from the Department of Labor.
Yes, indeed. We got the job numbers for the month of December that are out. They are not very, not that bad. We got some, the actual numbers, they added 252,000 jobs. The unemployment rate was at 5.8%. It's down to 5.6% now. The other interesting part here is in November, originally they were reported as 321,000 jobs added. Those were revised to over 350,000 jobs. So a big, big report there. The one bummer here that people are pointing out is that wage growth dropped. Wage growth went down, so it's kind of...
It had ticked up just a little bit the month before. But, you know, anything over 200,000 private sector jobs a month is good news. It's more than predicted. They predicted 245,000, predicted that the unemployment rate might tick down to 5.7, went to 5.6. So overall, it's, I think, the sixth month in a row that we've had over 200,000 new private sector jobs a month. And as President Obama goes on the road today down to Knoxville, Tennessee, that'll give him a little bragging rights.
Yeah.
The new book is Tasty, The Art and Science of What We Eat, author Pulitzer Prize winner John McQuaid here in studio with us. John, what's the most surprising thing that you learned from this, your research on this book?
Well, I learned what the hottest chili pepper in the world tastes like.
Oh, man.
That was an interesting experience.
I'll bet.
I took my son, who is the chili head, down to a grower in South Carolina, Ed Curry, who has grown this. It's now the Guinness Book of World Record holder for hottest chili pepper. And you can't eat very much of it. We got like a millimeter across slivers, and you pop it into your mouth, and it sort of it takes like 15 or 20 seconds and kind of fills your whole mouth with, this burning sensation.
Well, what's the point?
I'm not sure.
Seriously.
I love spicy food. I love spicy food. But there is a point where it just gets too damn spicy and you can't taste anything.
There's a whole growing subculture, though, of the super hot pepper. They've been getting hotter, like, over the last 5 or 10 years. It's, like, doubled, and people are really into it. Some people, it's like a test of your mettle to taste this and survive. And I think food cuisine in general has, over the last 20, 30 years, has grown more spicy because of, ethnic food in the U.S. Growing, and a lot of trends are kind of moving in a spicier direction. So I think to understand that, it's helpful to try the spiciest thing.
I had someone once tell me that a lot of these spicy foods originate in hotter climates. Because you eat this spicy food, and then it makes you sweat, which cools you down, which I think is BS. Have you heard that before?
Yes, yeah, that's one theory, and I think it's, I think that is kind of, I mean,
it just makes me hotter.
Yeah, I think, it's sort of true, perhaps. There are all these different theories about why people like hot peppers, and no one really has a good biological theory for it. There's like a psychological theory that it's sort of, benign form of masochism or riding a roller coaster. It's like a thrill, that people need to
it's a thrill I don't
feel
need.
Alive. So.
What percentage of what we eat is native? Like, for example, potatoes are not native to America, right? Tomatoes.
Native to South America, actually.
Okay, all right. I'm talking about the United States, I guess. Tomatoes?
Very few things.
No. Right. Yeah. Corn?
Corn, yes. Corn was grown in North and South America.
Okay. All right.
But of course, today's corn bears like almost no resemblance to corn.
Then,
yeah.
Right.
Grapes. 1,000 years ago.
Right. Vineyards were brought here from.
Yeah. Europe? Grapes originated. Yeah, like in Central Europe and Asia. So yeah. I mean, food. Native food is almost sort of meaningless now because everything is shipped all over the world and grown
and has taste engineered. Taste for red meat changed, meaning demand for it?
I'm not really sure what the trend is on there.
Are people eating as much red meat today as they did, used to?
I believe it, I'm just spitballing here. I believe it may have declined, because there have been health warnings about, fat and, because it is a very rich food that's not good in excess. So, but it's very good tasting. So,
right. Now, it seems to me that the demand is down, but just wondering if it's.
Are we supposed to eat meat? I hear a lot of vegetarians who say, we're even supposed to eat meat.
I mean, people have been eating meat for thousands of years, for, hundreds of thousands of years. I mean, it was part of what made humanity humanity, was learning how to slaughter, how to hunt game and kill it and cook it. That sort of helped, human brains get bigger. And so that's definitely part of our biological heritage.
Do you think you could you somehow convince me or teach me to eat to like something I don't now like to eat?
If you have an open mind,
Can you manipulate the taste buds?
It takes an open mind and it takes practice. You can't just do it in one sitting. I went to Iceland and I tried the semi-rotted shark meat that is a delicacy there.
Yeah.
And that tastes like ammonia and rotting fish.
Yeah.
You
know,
you
delicious.
You can smell it coming, you know, from a mile away. Yeah. But you know, they drink it with schnapps during the holidays.
Okay. Yeah.
I imagine the schnapps probably, you know, balances out the ammonia.
No. So I'll take the schnapps without the rotted fish.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, very good. Yeah. John McQuaid, congratulations so much. And again, check it out, folks. Go to our website, BillPressShow.com or Amazon.com. Tasty. Why you like what you like to eat. John McQuaid's cool, the author. Book. Thanks so much.
Great job.
I'll be right back.
This is the Bill Press Show.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC. Or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket. Again. It's like, hello? That's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide-and-go-seek.
A few years ago, plastic bag waste in our city came to a tipping point. It was clear. We had a bag problem. My department was tasked to reduce plastic bag consumption. We needed to come up with ways to change human behavior. So we asked ourselves,
should I get by?
What do people really hate?
Yep.
Getting punched in the stomach. Preliminary studies showed that the consequences weren't severe enough to warrant behavioral change.
Actually, can I get that double bagged?
So we thought, what do people hate more than getting punched in the stomach? Kissing Helga.
Hey, big boy.
People didn't find her so offensive after all, so we had to get creative.
How many bags? Okay, now pour this ice water down your pants.
We tried everything.
Eat the threat.
Defuse this bomb.
Even fighting your clone. After blowing through millions of dollars of government funds on research, I came up with a brilliant idea.
Why don't we just charge 5 cents per bag?
That's a stupid idea.
Would you like a bag?
Yes.
5 cents a bag.
5 cents? 5 cents? Do I still have the option of getting punched?
Honestly, I don't know how everyone else missed it.
Why don't you just get a reusable bag?
Okay, that's it for today. It was my Monday and my Friday. Thanks. Good to have you with us. Have a great weekend.
This
we'll see you back here on Monday.
Bill Press
have
Show.
A good one.